time on the show was fraught with personal challenges. Behind the scenes, she struggled with homesickness. And no, not in the traditional sense. She longed to be closer to her fiancé who lived in New York, miles and miles away from filming in California. This longing intensified as the series continued, making it increasingly difficult for Owen to remain on the West Coast.
Was that a nurgling?
Soon the separation from her loved one took a toll on Owen's emotional well-being. Did you even blame her? Despite voicing out her desire to leave, talent agent Monique James threatened to sue her. This made her very distressed, sometimes leaving the room in tears. However, her misery came to an end when she got out of her contract after 13 episodes. Her exit paved the way for Pat Priest to step into her role for the remainder of the series, while Owen pursued other opportunities that allowed her to be closer to home.
And commandments and other things that people...
Number 19, no lilies. Well, speaking of the women in the Munster family, did you know that in the original plot of the Munsters, Lily Munster didn't even exist? Yeah, you heard that right. Instead, Herman Munster's wife was initially Phoebe, portrayed by Joan Marshall. The script only flipped when the movie executives felt Marshall had a particularly uncanny resemblance to Morticia Adams from the rival show. This swift recasting decision led to Yvonne DiCarlo stepping into the iconic role of Lily Munster. But here's where things get interesting, and a bit dicey. You see, DiCarlo was a prominent Hollywood star, and she wasn't exactly liked by her cast members. In fact, she faced skepticism from Fred Quinn and Al Lewis, who doubted her ability to fit into the Munster family dynamic. Plus, it didn't also help that DiCarlo spent way too much time on her hair and makeup. This caused several delays on set, frustrating cast and crew alike. However, it didn't take long for DiCarlo to win them over. Quinn and Lewis eventually grew to appreciate her professionalism and comedic timing, ultimately forming a stronger working relationship with her. It may sound like a reach, but personally, I think that Yvonne DiCarlo's introduction as Lily Munster marked a significant turning point for the show. Without her, the Munsters may have never become the beloved classic we all know and love, despite its unconventional characters and storyline. Number 18, Eddie's recast. Like mother, like son. They say the apple doesn't fall far from the tree, but in the case of Lily and Eddie Munster, the casting certainly did. Yep, it sure seems like recasting seemed to be a common theme in the Munster family saga. While Yvonne DiCarlo was famously recast as Lily after the pilot, her on-screen son Eddie also saw a change in actors. In the original pilot episode, Eddie Munster was portrayed by Happy Dermot. However, executives felt Dermot's portrayal leaned too heavily into the wolf aspect of Eddie's character. When the series was greenlit, which Patrick took over the role, bringing his own charm to the half-wolf, half-human Munster child. In any case, despite the initial switch, which Patrick's portrayal of Eddie Munster's character remained a fan favorite throughout the show's original run and beyond. The story doesn't quite end there, though. Remember the 80s film revival? Well, ironically, while other cast members returned, Eddie Munster was again recast, this time with Casey Martell stepping into the role. Personally, I think all the actors did a good job portraying their film characters. Which of them was your favorite, though? Do tell us in the comments below. Number 17, no foul play. Since the beginning of the Munsters and the Addams Family runs on television, never-ending comparisons have been drawn between the pair, and it's pretty easy to see why. To start with, both shows depict the misadventures of an eccentric, loving family that never adheres to the rules, and interestingly enough, it premiered within a week of each other in 1964. But what if I told you that the rumors of sketchy copying from one studio to another were just one big misunderstanding? Yeah, while both shows share thematic similarity, eccentric families living outside societal norms, their development was largely coincidental, or at least not in the way most think. You see, CBS's Munsters, with its parody of Universal Studios' classic monster movies, began pre-production before ABC's The Addams Family. And the idea of a sitcom centered around a spooky yet comedic family dynamic...
I think I got to turn the mouse sensitivity down a little bit.
Networks. It's also worth mentioning that, script-wise, neither network was even aware of what the other was doing. The release dates were only so close because ABC intentionally fast-tracked their TV show based on Charles Addams' costume as to not let CBS have an unopposed opportunity to take over the gap in the market. Already knew about it? Well then, I'm absolutely certain you never saw this one. Number 16, the Munsters' unusual connection with Eva to Beaver. Did you know that the Munsters not only had family similarities with the Addams Family, but also another iconic TV show? While the Addams Family grabbed attention with its eerie charm, the Munsters found its own niche by offering a hilariously monstrous twist on a typical American sitcom, Leave It to Beaver. Before crafting the monster, Jeff Connelly and Bob Mosher, the creative minds
of about that blue one?
Took their sitcom expertise to a whole new level, taking the suburban bliss of Leave It to Beaver and flipping it into a haunted mansion full of oddities and laughter. Thus, the birth of the monster, a playful parody of spooky proportions. Call it a parody, if you will. Interesting. Both shows were filmed on the same Universal's picture lot. And if you were an eagle-eyed viewer, you might have spotted the monster's iconic house-making cameo appearances in Leave It to Beaver. This connection not only highlights the versatility of the studio lot, but also underscores the creative overlap between these seemingly disparate shows. So you see, while the Addams Family and the monsters battle for viewers' attention, the monster's subtle connection to Leave It to Beaver adds yet another layer to its unique charm and enduring appeal in television history. It's a masterpiece, really. Fred Gwynn's costume was very uncomfortable. Ah, Herman Munster, the lovable patriarch of the Munsters, whose towering presence and endearing clumsiness won the hearts of viewers everywhere. But while he undoubtedly made a mark on viewers, did you know that behind the scenes, Fred Gwynn probably hated every minute of being on the show? And no, his case wasn't quite like Beverly Owens' homesickness. You see, Gwynn's iconic Frankenstein costume, while a masterpiece of makeup and design, was a literal nightmare to wear. Imagine having to walk around in a costume that had 4-inch soles on asphalt paver's boots. Doesn't quite sound like a fun walk in the park, right? Then add to that several pounds of foam padding strapped to his body to achieve Herman's formidable build, with the studio lights beating down, making him incredibly hot. In fact, Gwynn shed 10 pounds in the first season alone from all the sweating. To help him cope, the crew had to improvise by using an air compressor to blow cold air into his costume between takes. This makeshift solution aimed to keep the actor cool, but despite lemonade breaks for hydration, Gwynn still endured back pain due to the weight and strain of the costume. So you see, always remember to put some respect in Gwynn's name. He went through extreme lengths and endured an insane amount of discomfort to bring Herman Munster to life on screen. Number 14. CBS changed the Munsters to feature the Universal Monsters. Say what you want about CBS, but the studio certainly knew how to capitalize on nostalgia and iconic characters. As the show was being developed, one of the studio's directors worked to incorporate characters that included monsters owned by Universal Studios. Basically, it was a typical nuclear family sitcom, except with Frankenstein's mother as the father and Dracula as the father-in-law. It was a bold move, but one that perfectly aligned with CBS's strategy to leverage the enduring popularity of Universal's classic horror films. Since the 1950s, the studio has been airing these beloved monster movies on television, building a dedicated fan base. The end result? By incorporating characters like Frankenstein's monster and Dracula into a sitcom, CBS ended up attracting both fans of the original film and new audiences who were all but intrigued by the novel twist. Now, from a practical standpoint, this approach has undoubtedly streamlined production. You see, the CBS studio could reuse props and costumes from Universal's extensive archive, ensuring authenticity and cutting costs, the latter of which studios definitely appreciate. Moreover, the integration of these recognizable characters made it easier to develop merchandise, further monetizing the show's popularity. In the end, it became a win-win situation for all parties involved. Number 13. The Munsters family and the plot isn't quite what you remember. When the Munsters was in its developing stages, there was a heated debate among executives. Should the series be animated or live action? Some argued for the lively, imaginative appeal of animation, while others favored the realism and charm of live action. Ultimately, though, they decided to go with live action, which gave the show its distinctive charm and allowed the actors to bring these iconic characters to life in a way that resonated with audiences. Speaking of which, did you know the pilot episode, originally titled My Fair Munster, served as a bridge between the show's conception and its iconic debut? Of course you did. Only diehard fans picked it up. In this episode, Grandpa attempts to play matchmaker by slipping a love potion into Marilyn's oatmeal, only to have it inadvertently consumed by Herman, Lily, and Eddie Munster instead, resulting in comedic chaos. There are some distinctions between the pilot version and the final version of Air. For one, the pilot was filmed in color, marking a departure from the eventual black and white aesthetic that became synonymous with the series. Joan Marshall also played Phoebe, and Happy Durman took on the role of Eddie Munster. As said earlier, executives felt Marshall resembled Morticia Addams too closely, and Dermot's portrayal of Etiquette was too wild and untamed. In response, Monte Carlo was brought in to embody Will Munster, while Butch Patrick was cast as Eddie. With some reshooting and editing, a revised version of the pilot eventually aired as the show's second episode, setting the stage for the Munster's enduring legacy as a quirky, supernatural sitcom beloved by audiences worldwide. Having fun? Keep watching, though, to get more shocking facts like this one.
Everyone is staring at me. I'm afraid to say this, but the explanation can be found in the nearest mirror.
Number 12. The show itself really could have been colored. Ever heard of the butterfly effect? It's the idea that small decisions can have large, unforeseen consequences. Well, here's a perfect example from television history. Back in the 60s, when color TV was just starting to become a thing, CBS faced a big decision. Should they film the Munsters in color or stick with a classic black and white? Color TV has been around since the 1950s, but at the time, it was still a luxury and quite expensive. This made CBS decide to play it safe and keep the Munsters in black and white. Why, you may ask? Well, there are a few theories. Some say they wanted to save cost, and others believe they thought black and white would make the show less scary for younger viewers. Another idea is that they wanted to maintain the same spooky tone as the classic Universal Monsters movies that inspired the series. Whatever the reason, little did they know, this might have contributed to the Munsters' eventual downfall. While black and white added to the show's eerie atmosphere, it also limited its appeal, especially as color TV sets became more popular. By the time ABC launched its colorful sensation, Batman, in 1996, world Munsters could never believe. The vibrant visuals of Batman drew viewers away from the monochrome world of the Munsters, leading to declining ratings and the show's cancellation after just two seasons. Alas, it makes me wonder what could have been had the Munsters been filmed in color from the start. Would it have been more popular? Would it have lasted longer? It's one of those what-ifs that leaves us wondering about alternate TV history. What's funny, though, is that the unaired pilot Nightmare Munster was actually filmed in color. Bet you never knew that. The decision to stick with black and white for the series was only made after a couple of test screenings. What do you think, though? Would the Munsters have been better off had it been broadcast in color? Would it have altered the show's popularity? Keep pondering that as we dive into the next shocking fact about this iconic TV series. Mayday, mayday. Spoilers ahead.
Make sure you get his reservations in a very nice place, because if there's anything we can stand, it's where we...
Number 11, Lily Munster was canonically stronger than Herman. Lily Munster, the matriarch of the Munster family, isn't just your average housewife. In fact, she's more than capable of holding her own, literally. While Herman Munster is
really?
A Frankenstein's monster, very often showcased his superhuman strength throughout the series, there's a surprising twist that not a lot of fans picked up on. Lily was canonically shown to be even stronger than her husband, Herman. In the episode, Follow That Munster, Lily's remarkable strength took center stage, and without giving away too much, let's just say that her prowess and power made quite an impression. Personally, I think the reveal was a delightful twist that added depth to her character and challenged traditional gender stereotypes. So if you're someone who appreciates strong female characters breaking the mold, Lily Munster's moments of strength are definitely worth revisiting. It's just one more reason why the Munsters remain the timeless classic of surprises around every corner.
I spoke at 144 different colleges in the last few years, and they broke attendance records at every one. The kids are cartoon freaks, they were.
Number 10, Mel Blanc is the voice of the Raven. In the eerie and whimsical world of the Munsters, even the cuckoo clock had its own unique twist. Instead of a typical bird chirping the hour away, the show decided to take things up a notch by having the Raven emerge with a dramatic Nevermore nod to Edgar Allan Poe's haunting poem. Who is the man behind this memorable voice, Raven? That's right, you guessed it. Behind the voice was none other than Mel Blanc, the Hollywood legend in the realm of voice acting. Known as the man of a thousand voices, did you also know that Mel Blanc brought to life an astonishing array of characters, from Bugs Bunny and Daffy Duck to Barney Rubble and Mr. Spacely? As a matter of fact, his innate talent spanned over 500 voices, making him a cornerstone of animated entertainment during his time. I can't even think of anyone who remotely comes close. For fans of the Munsters, Blanc's contribution added an extra layer of whimsy and dark humor to the already eclectic house of monsters. It's a testament to the show's attention to detail and quirky charm that even a minor character like the Raven Pot became a beloved part of television history. Number 9, Fred Gwynne and Al Lewis worked together before the show. guys, can we all agree that Fred Gwynn and Al Lewis, the dynamic duo behind Hermit Munster and Grandpa Munster, brought an unforgettable energy to the Munsters through their electrifying performances and undeniable chemistry? Individually, both actors had this amazing ability to suck an audience into their acting, but together, they were basically impeccable. And here's the thing, what if I told you the Munsters wasn't the first time they'd feature together? Fred Gwynn, known for his towering stature and deep voice, had previously gained recognition for his role in the police comedy sitcom Bar 54, Where Are You? Running from 1961 to 1963, the show portrayed the humorous escapades of two mismatched New York City police officers, showcasing Gwynn's knack for comedy and larger-than-life character. His portrayal of Herman Munster in The Munsters allowed him to blend his comedic timing with a touch of humanity, making Herman both endearing and hilarious. Al Lewis, on the other hand, brought a mischievous charm to Grandpa, finding Gwynn with a hint of supernatural flair, which added depth to the Munster family dynamics. In any case, their prior collaboration in Car 54, Where Are You, undoubtedly influenced their on-screen rapport in Munster. This shared history and chemistry between Gwynn and Lewis helped to authentically convey the close-knit and quirky Munster family dynamic, a crucial element that contributed to the show's enduring popularity. A sneaky story behind the building of Dragula. Despite having a minor role, Dragula, a macabre masterpiece on wheels, became an instant hit among fans of the Munster film. This ghoulish car, designed by project engineer George Barris, captured imaginations with its eerie charm and unconventional design. Its influence has been profound, inspiring various recreations over the years, including a song titled by rock musician Rob Zombie, paying homage to Grandpa Munster's spooky ride. But hey, have you ever pondered its genesis? As amazing and surreal as the car looks, what makes the Dragula even more intriguing is its own story, a tale steeped in legal hurdles and creative problem solving. In North Hollywood, where the show is filmed, renting a copy without a death certificate was strictly forbidden. But as the man he is, George Barris, known for his innovative car design,
I knew that was going to do. Come on!
Clandestine deal with a local funeral director, exchanging cash for a casket, which was discreetly picked up from the funeral home's back door. This daring maneuver allowed Barris and his team to bring the Dragula to life, adding an authentic touch to the show's spooky aesthetic. Despite appearing in only one episode, the Dragula's impact and legacy remain one of the most dazzling and captivating facts about the Munsters. We wouldn't dare make this list without talking about it. Number 7. The connection between Grandpa and Frankenstein's lab.
What the fuck? What did I die from?
History was Dr. Frankenstein's lab in the 1931 film Frankenstein. This laboratory, filled with buzzing electrical equipment, barking machines, and bubbling beakers, became the archetype for mad scientist labs in cinema. Its atmospheric design, complete with eerie lighting and intricate props, set a new standard for horror film aesthetics, giving a lasting impression on audiences. But who was the mastermind behind this legendary set? Enter Kenneth Strickfaden, a renowned special effects specialist of his time and a visionary mind responsible for bringing Dr. Frankenstein's lab to life. His meticulous attention to detail and innovative use of electrical effects created an unforgettable backdrop that enhanced the film's chilling narrative. Fast forward to the 1960s, and Strickfaden's expertise once again was sought after, this time for the television series The Munsters. Serving as the head of the special effects crew, Strickfaden brought his expertise to Grandpa Munster's laboratory. And guess what? Many of the props and gadgets used in Grandpa's lab bore striking resemblances to those from Frankenstein, bridging the gap between the classic horror film and the comedic homage of the Munsters. This connection not only added authenticity to the show, but also honored the legacy of films that inspired the creation of characters like Herman Munster. So you see, through Strickfaden's visionary design, both Frankenstein and the Munster shared a visual continuity that connected the show's homage to classic horror cinema with its own unique comedic twist. His contributions ensured that Grandpa's lab became as iconic in television history as Dr. Frankenstein's lab was in the realm of film. Admit it, you've been pretty shocked by most of the reveals so far. So why don't you hit the subscribe button and turn on the notification bell so you stay updated with our latest content. It'll only take you a second. While you're here, let's uncover another extraordinary and surprising fact about the Munsters TV show that you probably didn't know. Number 6. The secret behind the Munsters comic book. Remember how the Munsters were all in our faces at their peak? I'm certainly not complaining though. In the wake of its television success, the show quickly became a national sensation, captivating audiences with its quirky blend of humor and horror. And it didn't stop there. As the show gained popularity, fans clamored for merchandise featuring their favorite friendly monster. This demand sparked a lucrative market for products ranging from toys and board games to clothing and novelty items, all adorned with the likeness of Herman, Lily, Grandpa, and the rest of the Munster family. However, behind the scenes of this merchandise boom lay an unexpected challenge for the Munster family foray into the comic book industry. The Comics Code Authority, established in the 1950s to regulate content in comic books, imposed strict guidelines that included a ban on depicting vampires, indirectly posing a significant hurdle for the Munsters, given Grandpa Munster's obvious vampire identity. Enter Gold Key Comics, an independent publisher operating outside the jurisdiction of the Comics Code Authority. Recognizing the potential of the Munsters brand, Gold Key took a bold step and published a series of comic books featuring the lovable monster. From 1965 to 1968, they released a total of 16 issues of the Munsters comics, circumventing industry norms by prominently featuring four color photographs of the show's cast and stills from the series on their cover. By sidestepping the traditional comic book regulations, Gold Key's daring move not only satisfied the fervent fan base of the Munsters, but also paved the way for other non-traditional comic adaptations. Their innovative approach allowed readers to immerse themselves in new adventures with their beloved Munster characters, untethered by the limits of mainstream comic book censorship. Number 5. Al Lewis was not the first choice to play Grandpa. Speaking of vampires, can we take a moment to appreciate Grandpa? Among the quirky characters that populated the show, Grandpa stood out as a fan favorite. With his unique blend of humor and old-world vampire antics, Grandpa Munster captivated audiences worldwide. His character added a delightful layer of supernatural charm to the show, making him an essential part of its enduring appeal. Behind all of it was Al Lewis, the man who brought Grandpa Munster to life with his iconic portrayal. His comedic timing and theatrical flair not only endeared him to audiences, but also solidified Grandpa Munster as a beloved character in television history. However, what if I told you that we were so close to missing out on Lewis's masterpiece? You see, before Al Lewis was cast as Grandpa Munster, the role went through several considerations, and he wasn't the first choice for the character. The creators of the show preferred Burt Barr, who was already famous for his role as the Cowardly Lion in The Wizard of Oz, as their ideal candidate for Grandpa Munster. However, for reasons that remain somewhat ambiguous in historic records, Burt Barr declined the role of Grandpa Munster. This shocking decision paved the way for Al Lewis to audition for the role, and well, the rest is history.
Boy, you tell me what you want to tell me.
No, dear, you let me go first, because what I have to say will save our marriage.
Number 4. Lily Munster was older than Grandpa. They say vampires can live forever, but have you ever seen one older than her grandfather? Well, enter the Munster, the eerie TV show where there's always more than meets the eye. Throughout the show's run, Al Lewis brought Grandpa Munster to life, playing an elderly vampire who fondly reminisced about the good old days. However, don't let the role deceive you about the actor's actual age. As surprising as it sounds, Al Lewis was actually a year younger than Yvonne DiCarlo, who portrayed Lily Munster, his character's daughter on the show. Both of them were younger than Fred Quinn, who played Herman Munster. Behind the scenes, the actors wore extensive makeup, enough to conceal any signs of age or other characteristics. The behind-the-scenes magic helped maintain the illusion of these timeless characters, captivating the audiences with their comedic and supernatural charm. I mean, just take a look at this. Despite their real ages, the performances of Al Lewis, Yvonne DiCarlo, and Fred Quinn ensured that the Munster family remained beloved icons of television history, showcasing the enduring appeal of their otherworldly humor and familial dynamics. But before we go into the next shocking fact of the day, remember when I told you that Beverly Owens hated being on the show and that she was replaced by Pat Reese? You're not going to believe how the latter got the role. Number 3, the shocking truth behind the priest's role. Ever heard the saying, one man's food is another man's poison? Well, let's just say that the Munster show was a perfect example of that. For Beverly Owens, playing Marilyn Munster like poison, she couldn't wait to leave the role and reunite with her lover back east. It was a stark contrast to Pat Priest, who not only gladly stepped in for the role, but, hey, was practically born for it. You see, Pat Priest's casting as Marilyn Munster was serendipitous in many ways. Not only was she the daughter of United States Treasurer Ivy Baker Priest, but she also shared physical similarities with Owens. Blonde, like the character was originally envisioned, and standing at the same height with nearly identical measurements, Priest fit into all the existing Maryland outfits and accessories perfectly. This stroke of luck meant that the show's wardrobe department could seamlessly transition to using existing costumes without the need for costly replacements, saving valuable production resources. Priest's tenure as Marilyn Munster not only brought continuity to the character, but also allowed her to bring her own charm and interpretation to the role, further solidifying her place in the Munster's legacy. I've seen countless instances where changes in casting and costume design behind the scenes result in disastrous transitions. However, Pat Priest's portrayal of Marilyn Munster was the complete opposite. Her transition was as smooth as silk. It was almost providential, don't you think?
And sometimes you're a goofball, but I love you.
Say that. Number two, the Munsters very nearly started in 1943 as a cartoon. Beyond the uncharted ifs and had-beens that could have changed the fate of Hollywood, I can't help but feel that the Munster stands out. You see, not a lot of people know this, but back in the 1940s, the show almost completely took a different form altogether. During the 1940s, Universal Studios was at the height of its monster movie era, producing classics like The Invisible Man Returns, The Wolfman, and Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman. Bob Clampett, famous for creating iconic characters like Porky Pig and Daffy Duck, moved on from Warner Brothers cartoons to television, where he pioneered creator-driven series with shows like Time for Beanie and Beanie and Cecil. And it was then that Bob Clampett, already known for his impactful work on Looney Tunes, pitched Universal the idea of a family of funny monsters. Yep, as crazy as it sounds. Just imagine an alternate world where the live-action sitcom went from this to a cartoon featuring funny monsters, pitched during Universal's heyday of monster flicks like The Invisible Man and Frankenstein Meets the Wolfman. Alas, his vision for the Munster family never materialized. Decades later, the Munster show, which we all know and love, made it to our TV screens as a black-and-white release. But hey, it makes me wonder how amazing it would have been if the Munsters had started as a cartoon. Would it have thrived on its own pitch, perhaps avoiding the obscurity brought on by the colored Batman series? We may never know for certain, but it is certainly intriguing to imagine alternate realities where numerous monsters roam in animated form, captivating audiences in ways we can only speculate about. In any case, you might want to brace yourselves for the ultimate twist you definitely never saw coming. Number one, the Munster's original pitch was stolen. Yes, you definitely heard it right. In the 1960s, television was transitioning from traditional family sitcoms to more offbeat and supernatural themes, spurred on by shows like Bewitched, I Dream of Jeannie, and My Favorite Martian. This era welcomed everything from witches and genies to aliens and talking animals, reflecting a growing appetite for unconventional storytelling. Enter Alan Burns and Chris Hayward, who, after collaborating on cartoons like The Rocky and Bullwinkle Show, pitched the concept to Universal Studios for a quirky family sitcom inspired by Charles Adams' darkly humorous cartoons. Their idea revolved around a family of weirdos, echoing the macabre charm of Adams' creations. Unfortunately, their pitch was passed on by their contract with Universal without crediting them. It wasn't until the Writers Guild of America intervened that Burns and Hayward received recognition for their contribution. In the credits of the Munsters, their involvement is acknowledged as from a format by. Despite this setback, Alan Burns went on to co-create iconic shows like The Mary Tyler Moore Show and Rhoda, which thankfully left a good legacy in television comedy. It's a reminder that even in the creative world of television, ideas can be borrowed, adapted, and sometimes not credited properly, but talent and resilience can still prevail in shaping memorable entertainment. There you have it, 20 of the most shocking truths about the Munster TV show. No matter how big of a fan you are, we're certain many of these revelations left your mouth wide open. If you found these stories as fascinating as we did, click the like button and let us know in the comments which revelation surprised you the most. Wait, before you go, there's plenty more where that came from. Be sure to watch the video currently displaying on your screen for another astonishing revelation about the hidden truths of Hollywood. See you there.
Edward Krueger, later known as Fred, or most commonly Freddy, was born in the early 1940s as the son of a nun named Amanda Krueger. She was part of a religious order that ran an asylum known as Weston Hills and did volunteer work there from time to time. When Amanda was young, she was accidentally locked in a ward that was criminally insane over the holidays, and the inmates kept her hidden for days. When she was found, she was barely alive and now pregnant with a child.
Fred.
the bastard son of a hundred meters.
While we don't know who the true biological father is, it was probably this guy, just based on their similar appearance. According to Alice Johnson's research on Freddy, Amanda gave birth at that very same asylum. I imagine she delivered the baby here, as opposed to a normal hospital, out of shame, since nuns are supposed to be celibate. She was panicked throughout the entire childbirth, and the baby was breech, meaning that he was going to come out feet first instead of head first. There's probably some symbolism surrounding the fact that Freddy was born upside down, with the mother being a nun and an upside down cross being associated with the devil. Because through his disastrous life experiences and eventual demonic intervention, Freddy would indeed become the antithesis to God. To learn about Freddy's childhood, how he became the demon of dreams, the timeline pieced together using bits of information throughout the franchise, how he represents various scientific sleep phenomena, and what the future now holds for Freddy Krueger, stick around to the end of this video. This video is sponsored by Audible.
Welcome! Ready, Michael?
No, please shut up. Just please shut up. But welcome to horror history. Can you believe I'm finally doing Freddy?
Frederick!
And that's actually a good clip for me to introduce this character, because like Major League Baseball these days, the rules are constantly changing in the Elm Street franchise. Freddy debuted as a dangerous dream spirit in the original A Nightmare on Elm Street, but by the second one, they had already changed the rules, making him possess people in the real world to do his bidding. And throughout the rest of the franchise, the rules keep changing. Obviously, the best version of Freddy would just be to disregard everything after the first one, but that's not why you watch horror history, is it? I'm gonna try to make sense of his entire timeline, but when it comes to the rules, there are obviously going to be inconsistencies. And I, obviously, am going to ridicule them. I think what makes Freddy special for a lot of people is that he was always played by the classically trained actor Robert Englund. But that almost wasn't the case. In 1985, during the production of A Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Freddy's Revenge, New Line Cinema wanted to save money by just putting some nobody in a rubber mask out there. Which would have been funny, but also very bad. And the studio realized that, and Englund got his check. And probably a huge apology. You can still see the masked version of Freddy right here, but in this shot, you can't really tell. But you can try to impress your friends with that knowledge. No one will care. Hopefully, they'll tell you to get a grip on your life. Of course, there is no Freddy Krueger without his iconic finger blade glove. According to director Wes Craven, this was inspired by his pet cat, who destroyed his couch with its claws, making him ponder his primal human fears of being clawed to death by a saber-toothed tiger in nature. I guess he was still not over it 12 years later when he had Billy Loomis go to town on that couch and scream. But to fully understand the bastard cat of $100+ of ruined furniture, we've got to take it back to his childhood and how he learns to never show mercy on the kids. Put up for adoption from a young age, and if I had to guess, it was basically right away, given Amanda's shame about having a child. This didn't stop his classmates from learning who he was and bullying him for it, chanting his nickname, Son of a Hundred Maniacs. By the mid to late 1940s, he had already developed the murderous tendencies that would carry over into his adulthood. At one point, he can be seen smashing the class hamster with a mallet. It seems even then, he'd taken a liking to wearing red and green stripes. Fred's adopted father is later found to be extremely abusive, so it's likely that the abuse at home and at school is what led Freddy to becoming abusive himself. There's clinical research to back this. The rate of abuse among individuals with a history of abuse is approximately 6 times higher. By his teenage years, Freddy learned to embrace the pain, going so far as to slice himself with a razor while laughing just for entertainment. By this point, taking the belt from his adopted father was nothing to him, and he mockingly thanks him for the lashes.
You want to know the secret of pain? Just stop feeling it. You can start using it.
Is there any basis in reality for this? I think this is obviously an exaggerated version of a real concept, and that concept is masochism, or the tendency to derive pleasure from one's own pain or humiliation. And masochism is often associated with bedroom activities. We can only theorize as to why people develop this, condition. There are a number of theories out there, which I have read about, for the video guys, for the video, one of which is linked to trauma. The idea is that the victim of the trauma, in this case Freddy, is finding a way to take control of this pain that was previously out of his control as a coping mechanism. It's basically the same idea as when someone says, you can't fire me, I quit.
You can't put me on hold! I'll push you on hold!
I think it's an interesting thing to keep in mind as we continue forward in his story, because while it's never explicitly said outright, there are some clues that there may be a carnal side to his slashings in spring. But despite all of his issues, or maybe because of them, he manages to find a wife named Loretta, and together they have a daughter, Catherine Krueger, who was born in 1958. And I know this because we're told that Catherine was taken away from him in 1966, and her adoption papers state that she was adopted at 8 years old. The family lived together on Elm Street. It was at some point during Catherine's life that Fred began kidnapping and killing children in town, earning himself a new nickname, the Springwood Killer. Yeah, keep working on that one, Springwood Gazette headline writers. Freddy also crafted his own glove, using a blowtorch and some welding tools in his basement. For each victim he took, he documented the moment in a scrapbook, as well as an array of souvenirs that he kept in his basement workshop. One day, Catherine moseyed into the basement where her father kept newspaper clippings, photos, and other evidence of his crime. It seems early on, he had an array of prototype gloves in addition to the finger blade glove that we all know and love. Like one with shorter knives seemingly taped to his fingertips, one with nails affixed to his knuckles, and one with shorter, curved claws that looks to be made of copper. While Catherine is browsing through all of this, Freddy is up in the backyard, shaking and beating Loretta for discovering his secret collection. He would indeed take Loretta's life over this, but he covered it up well enough to make police think that she had just gone missing. Mrs. Krueger, wife of Fred Krueger, just disappeared without a trace, according to Detective Smith of the Springwood Police Department. I mean, did they not check his basement? Something tells me this Detective Smith is maybe not Springwood's greatest. Freddy did find out that his daughter also stumbled across the room, but he seemed satisfied with letting her live, and just threatening her not to tell anyone. This would eventually come back to bite him in the nose, but not for many more years. Catherine was relocated to the orphanage in 1966, but Freddy would go on terrorizing the town for a couple of years, and the body count would continue to pile higher. Then, there was his job.
Wow, what is this place?
Fred Krueger worked here. It's
another. This is how Freddy managed to evade police as long as he did. I'm guessing after the scare with Loretta, Freddy decided it was too risky to continue working out of his home, and instead took the kidnapped kids to the boiler room at this power plant. It's estimated that he took 20 to 30 kids.
It drove us crazy when we didn't know.
I don't know, maybe the weird guy whose wife disappeared and whose daughter was confiscated by the state? Anyway, it took a couple years, but police finally had that big brain moment and arrested Frederick Krueger in 1968. I know this because this newspaper in the Dream Child announces the death of Freddy's mother and says he was recently arrested in connection with the Springwood Child murders, and Amanda Krueger's grave says that she died in 1968. Freddy was put on trial, but in the end, someone didn't sign the search warrant in the right place, and Krueger was set free just like that. The public was furious, with headlines reading, "Child molester acquitted, citizens outraged." And this is actually the only place where Freddy is directly accused of being more than just a child killer. But there are more covert clues, which I will go over as we go along. I'd imagine that he was suspected of both, but the prosecution just wanted to focus on the murder charges because that was their strongest case. In real life, Freddy actually was supposed to be a molester in an early version of the script for the first movie, but they dropped that part around 1982 or 1983 when some high-profile cases involving a daycare started making news cycles, and producers didn't want it to look like they were exploiting that. If you watch my channel, you know that this isn't the only time that director Wes Craven was censored due to current events. See my video on screen 3. Anyway, when the law failed to take down Krueger, the parents of Elm Street decided to take things into their own hands.
We found him in an old abandoned boiler room where he used to take his kids. He took gasoline, poured it all around the place, and made a trail out.
After that, all they had to do was toss a Molotov cocktail through the window and watch the fireworks. Yet, by some divine prank, Freddy had been chosen by a higher power. Maybe they saw potential in him because of his ability to ignore pain, or maybe it was merely his infamy and notoriety in Springwood that made him an ideal candidate. But in his final moments, Freddy is approached by 3 dream demons who offer him the opportunity to become eternal.
Freddy, we know what you want.
I want it all!
What's it? Then open up!
And you shall be forever!
Not much is known about the dream demons, but they seem to go back to ancient Greek times, suggesting that Freddy's new role as a dream spirit could almost be like a second coming of Epialis, the Greek demon of nightmare. The word Epialis means feverish chill, or daemon who assaults sleepers. The dream demons themselves are depicted outside of the temple of Morpheus, Morpheus being the Greek god of dreams and nightmares.
These are ancient dream demons, supposedly they roam the dreams of the living, to defy the most evil, twisted human imagination, and they give them the power to cross the line.
In any event, there's a lot of controversy regarding Krueger's death, and each headline seemed to tell a different story. Some say he died in a fire, others suggest suicide, while some detail a vigilante-style kill. The parents hid his remains at Penny Road Auto Salvage, somewhere that they knew nobody would find his bones, because nobody ever salvages anything from an auto salvage. Finally, one woman, Marge Thompson, took the knife clawed glove and hid it in her basement as some kind of reassurance that it wouldn't fall back into the wrong hands. All seemed well for a few years, but then children started dying off again. There's an in-memoriam section at the high school, which seems to begin with 3 deaths in 1975, 7 years after Freddy was burned to death. The problem just seemed to get worse from then on, but I'd imagine that nothing could really be done because nobody knew what was causing these deaths. To an outsider, these may have appeared to be cases of suns, or sudden unexpected nocturnal death syndrome. This was a phenomenon observed in Southeast Asian refugees in the early 80s, where seemingly healthy young men just died in their sleep. This syndrome is actually what inspired Craven to write A Nightmare on Elm Street. In an interview with Vulture, he recounted how he read about a boy from Cambodia who was afraid he'd be attacked in his dreams and never woke up. When he finally fell asleep, his parents thought this crisis was over. Then, they heard screams in the middle of the night. By the time they got to him, he was dead. He died in the middle of a nightmare. While the adults didn't have much in the way of a logical explanation, the kids passed down a nursery rhyme through each generation, warning of the haunting of Freddy. But the next line of the song is the most intriguing. 5-6, grab your crucifix, which seems to compare Freddy to some kind of anti-Christ figure that you can protect yourself against using a cross, much like a vampire. But is this the case, or is it just urban legend? In March 1981, Nancy Thompson, the daughter of the woman who confiscated Freddy's finger blade glove, would find out for herself. But this is the point where I have to pause and explain the timeline a little bit more. These movies don't often reference the date, so I had to do a little puzzle solving. One of the few concrete dates is June 1989, when the graduation ceremony occurs in A Nightmare on Elm Street 5. From there, we can work backwards. In Elm Street 4, Alice has a driver's license. So at the earliest, this is 1987. Kristen's tombstone states that she was born in 1969, and she's still in high school, which means at the latest, it's 1987. So Elm Street 4 takes place in 1987, and this is backed up by the poster for the movie Prison, which came out in 87. A Nightmare on Elm Street 3 takes place a little bit before the 4th one, because in 4 they start school together in the fall. So Dream Warriors is most likely spring or summer of that same year. And in Dream Warriors, Nancy says this. Rose.
6 years ago, he killed my
parents. Which means the original Nightmare on Elm Street took place in 1981. And according to Nancy's diary, which is found in the second movie, the weird dreams began around March 15th.
March 15th. It comes to me at night. Horrible, ugly, dirty. I've never seen him. Tearing at my nightgown with his steel claw. His name is Fred. He's trying to take me to the
But why does he want to kill her? It's really pretty simple. The more children's souls he collects, the more powerful he becomes. And he also needs to make himself known as an urban legend in order to strike fear into the town. Because if people forget about him, he'll be in danger of losing the power to invade dreams. So in March 1981, he chooses 4 new targets in his old neighborhood on Elm Street. Nancy Thompson, Tina Gray, Rod Lane, and Glenn Wright. And each of them have dreams where Freddy began to scare them. Tina's dream includes the appearance of a lamb in a damp hallway, which represents the sacrificial lamb found in many religions, a clue about her becoming the first sacrifice of the friend group. From there, she goes to the boiler room, which is Freddy's main domain. She's cornered in front of a furnace, flames blazing behind her. This room represents hell, and Freddy represents the devil that presides over it. Like something that could only happen in a nightmare, Freddy suddenly appears behind her, and she awakens with a scream, finding her nightgown torn. I think you could also look at the torn clothing as a more subtle way of Craven, including the detail about Freddy also being a different type of predator when it comes to the minors that he sees. Nancy and Rod both experience similar dreams that night, so the next day, both couples stay at Tina's. Nancy, at first glance, seems to be protected by the crucifix in the bedroom that she's staying in, because Freddy seems to retract after starting to cross the threshold. Tina, on the other hand, would not be so lucky, and finds herself in another nightmare scenario. If you really want to fully understand everything there is to know about Freddy Krueger, it's important to also understand his creator, Wes Craven, the writer and director of the original movie. And the best way to do this is to check out his biography, Wes Craven, The Man and His Nightmares, now available on Audible. Starting from his childhood, this book takes you through the intricacies of his career and personal life, including some lesser-known details of A Nightmare on Elm Street. Right now, with my link, users can get a free trial of Audible. As an Audible member, you get to choose one title a month to keep. As a member, you also get full access to a growing selection of included audiobooks, Audible originals, and podcasts. It's easy to download from any device with the Audible app, even yours. It's the perfect way to create time to check out more titles, whether you're relaxing, on the go, or multitasking. You can even listen to Audible to drown out the mundanities of life and the incessant flow of time leading to your mortality. But it's easy. How do we get Audible free for 30 days? It's easy. Just go to audible.com/CZsWorld or text CZsWorld to 500-500. And then you can figure it out from there. That's audible.com/CZsWorld or text CZsWorld to 500-500 for your free trial. Freddy lures Tina into an alley using a mysterious voice, then, after rolling a trash can lid in her direction to startle her, reveals his horrifying appearance, arms extended unnaturally to scrape the wall with his bladed glove. Tina's first reaction is to seek help in God, but Freddy, persistently in opposition to religion, mocks her God with his response.
Please, God,
He chases her back to the house, demonstrating the ability to warp around the dream scene, slice off his own fingers with no pain, and have his face torn away. Remember, he's been doing this for some time at this point, and has already developed tricks to terrify and torture his victims using dream life. He pins her down and slashes her through the chest before dragging and tossing her body all around the room. The others are woken up by the commotion and don't manage to get any sleep after seeing the scene, so it isn't until the next day that Freddy is able to target Nancy, who falls asleep in class. Freddy is able to manipulate the dreams of his victim, so he causes Nancy to see her best friend in a body bag, the first in a trail of breadcrumbs that he uses to draw her in. He shapeshifts into a hall monitor, who she runs into on her way to the basement, which turns out to be none other than Freddy's boiler. The school basement never disappoints in a horror movie. I remember when I was in high school on one of the last days, I was just walking around, not in class, and I saw the principal walking around and asked him to show me the basement. It's the one place in the school that I had never seen. And he did. He didn't even question why I wasn't in class. And it just goes to show. Sometimes, you just gotta ask for things. Like asking you to subscribe. Freddy emerges from behind a boiler and slices his own chest just as he used to as a boy. But this time, it reveals maggots and green oodles. He laughs maniacally as he chases her around. But unlike Tina, Nancy manages to wake herself up at the end by reaching for a hot pipe. But thanks to the power given to him by the dream demons, any injuries that he dishes out in dreams also carry through to real life. And then Nancy wakes up, realizing that the burn is real. Not to be deterred, Freddy continues to haunt Nancy's dreams whenever she falls asleep, like when she dozes off in the bathtub and he pulls her under the surface, once again hinting at that metaphor that the studio didn't want to include blatantly. In another dream, Freddy visits Rod, who's being held in jail as a suspect in Tina's death. He gives chase, continuing to use images of Tina to torture her, but ultimately, Nancy's alarm clock saves her. Perhaps wanting an easier target, or perhaps realizing it'll have a psychological effect on Nancy if another one of his friends dies, Freddy turns his efforts to Rod, kills him in his dream, and stages it as a suicide. He goes for another round with Nancy after this. However, I don't have the details, because we see this dream from an outside perspective while Nancy is being studied at the Katia Sleep Institute. However, it must have been pretty traumatic, because she wakes up with a fresh trio of cuts on her arm, a strand of gray hair, and a souvenir.
What's something out for my—
At some point the next night, Freddy calls the phone in her bedroom. She's expecting to hear from her boyfriend, Glenn, but it turns out to be more of a nuisance. The tongue protrudes out of the receiver and licks her, causing her to spike the phone and destroy it. That's still preferred to getting a telemarketer. It wouldn't be the last time that Freddy used his tongue to freak out a victim, and it all ties into the inappropriate subtext of his character. But Nancy isn't even asleep for that, so how did Freddy get to her in the waking world? At this point, Nancy is running out empty. She's mostly stayed awake 24/7 for the last few days, and her body really needs sleep. There's something called hypnagogic hallucinations, also known as waking dreams. These are brief hallucinations that take place as you're falling asleep. They can be visual, auditory, or physical. You may have experienced this in a minor capacity. You're about to fall asleep and you hear someone say your name, but there's nobody there. Or you hear your phone buzz, but there's no notification. Now that I've looked into hypnagogic hallucination, I actually think it may explain a mystery that's always haunted me. I used to do production sound for movies and video, and in one indie film that I did, they were putting us up in an Airbnb, and I got stuck rooming with this guy that snored super loud, like incredibly loud. You would not believe how loud it was if you heard it in person. So it was kind of hard to fall asleep, but just as I was finally falling asleep, I feel myself get bounced. Like someone had jumped on the air mattress I was
fucked up.
So immediately I wake up and I look around and there's nobody there. The guy's still snoring on the other side of the room and there was no one else around. I'm not a believer when it comes to ghosts, but I've never been able to explain that one until I learned about waking dreams, which can include physical hallucinations as well. So I think that's what's happening to Nancy here. Her body is shutting down and those hallucinations are starting to happen while she's still awake, allowing Freddy to affect her in the real world in a minor way. But meanwhile, across the street, Glenn has fully fallen asleep, and just like Nancy was pulled underwater in the bath, Freddy pulls Glenn down into a void in his bed, moments before a fountain of blood explodes from it, completely repainting the ceiling in the room. With all three of Nancy's friends now dead, Freddy uses them against her as she intentionally travels back into Dreamland, hoping to bring Freddy out into the real world with her. As she travels down into the boiler room, she hears echoes of her dead friends calling to her, and Freddy's laughter as he taunts her. He stalks her from around corners as she goes deeper into the boiler room, eventually chasing her through dream space back to her house, but to his surprise, instead of running from him, she tackles him, just before her alarm goes off and takes her back to the world of the away. I don't want to get too picky here because none of this is real, but I feel like if Freddy Krueger was real, that this plan wouldn't work, because clocks never seem to work properly in a dream. And also, you can have a dream that feels really long, but it was actually pretty short in real world time. They do an amazing job of conceptualizing this in the movie Inception. Anyway, Freddy is carried through, back into the real world for the first time in 13 years. But that's not going to stop him from going after her. Only he finds that in this world, everything has been rigged with traps. He opens a locked door, only to be gut-checked with a hammer, trips over a wire that sets off an exploding light bulb, and gets bombarded with a jug of kerosene to set the stage for a Freddy-flavored barbecue. But this is nothing that he hasn't dealt with before. The now flaming Freddy stays high on her heels, literally, but he's door-checked back down the stairs. Still, he's somehow able to break out of the basement and sneak past Nancy up the stairs and into the room of Nancy's mother, Marge, one of the parents responsible for killing him the first time and stealing his blood. Still ablaze, he strangles her in her sleep until Nancy finds him and breaks a chair over his back. But when the flames are extinguished by Nancy's dad, they see Marge's charred remains sink back into the dreamscape, with Freddy nowhere to be found. My interpretation is that since Freddy found Marge asleep, he was able to use her to escape back into the world of dreams, taking her life in the process. But this battle is not over yet. As Nancy takes a moment to herself in her room, Freddy takes the opportunity to stretch the fabric of reality, and apparently the fabric of this bedsheet, once more. But this time, Nancy seems to have him figured out.
You think you're just gonna believe me?
I know you too well now, Freddy.
Nancy is finally able to divest him of his power by turning away and depriving him of the energy he needs by refusing to believe he's real or be afraid. As he tries to stab her in the back, he disintegrates into a cosmic shadow and disappears. As I mentioned a lot, the rules tend to change a lot in this franchise, but there are a few other moments that are consistent with Freddy's defeat here. In A Nightmare on Elm Street 2, Nancy further explains how she eventually beat Freddy on the last page of her diary.
He is evil itself. I know now that I got him. Gave him all the energy he needed, our screams.
The concept is touched on again in Freddy vs. Jason, which we'll get to. Despite seeming to find the key to fend off Freddy, Nancy's defense would not stand forever. After nearly trapping Nancy in his nightmare convertible, she was somehow able to escape Freddy's grasp and wake up again. She was quickly becoming his greatest rival, but that rivalry would be interrupted, because in the aftermath of Freddy's 1981 rampage, Nancy was determined to have gone crazy, or at least that's the story that circulated the town. She was put on an experimental dream suppression drug known as Hypnosil, and surprisingly, this seemed to do the trick. With no more dreams, Freddy had no way to access them, and he eventually had to move on to a new target. It would appear that none of these other kids gave him quite as much trouble as Nancy had. Remember, these names in the memoriam are just the high school fatalities, and don't account for any kids of other ages. But he claimed at least six more teens in 1982, at least seven in 1983, and literally pages worth in 84 and 85. The next notable victim to put up another fight to warrant the creation of another Nightmare on Elm Street movie came in 1986, 5 years after the Nancy Thompson show.
I know this
thing
is 5 years old.
You know her?
Yeah,
a man named Ken Walsh buys the vacant house, the now infamous 1428 Elm Street, and his son Jesse Walsh takes up residence in Nancy's old room. It doesn't take long for his dreams to get dark, including one where Freddy is a school bus driver who drives them into a giant fissure to hell, and one where he sees Freddy retrieving the finger blade glove from the boiler in the basement and asks for his help on some special work.
Hey, Jesse, we got special work to do here.
Necessary information, Jesse is gay, so Kruger's remarks here are once again playing into those psychosexual themes, which I talk about more in my Things You Missed episode on Freddy's Revenge. But to quickly sum it up, the Jesse arc follows different rules than the Nancy arc, and this time, Freddy's goal is to take over Jesse's body and make him do the thing, as a metaphor for the shame that Jesse feels by still being closeted about his sexuality. This comes out again the next night, when Jesse has a dream where it's so hot that everything in his room is melting. So he goes to the basement, where he finds Freddy's glove hidden in the furnace, and Freddy encourages him to try putting it on and kill him. The following evening, the Walsh's pet bird breaks out of its cage, flies around, attacks the family, then bursts into flames.
See, it's gotta be a rational explanation. Animals just don't explode into flames and rain.
Excellent observation, Ken. The moment also represents the point where Freddy isn't just limited to dreams anymore, for some reason. His next move comes later that night, while Jesse's gym teacher is making him run laps as punishment for sneaking into a bar. Freddy brings all the gym equipment to life and uses it to attack the coach, eventually tying him up with a jump rope before taking control of Jesse's body and using it to slash Coach Snyder in the back. When the fog clears, Jesse finds himself wearing the glove that he found the other night. He screams when he realizes what he's done, which suggests that this time, Freddy is using his powers to simulate another sleepwalking, somnambulism, more commonly known as sleepwalking. But once again, it's not very realistic that Freddy would be able to control a sleepwalker. Sleepwalking occurs during non-REM sleep, during which there are no dreams. said when someone sleepwalks, they aren't actually acting out their dreams. It's more of a misfired signal in the brain. But we have seen Freddy demonstrate an ability to toss around someone whose dream he's invading, like what happened with Tina and Glenn, for example. So maybe he's just doing that in a more controlled way to manipulate Jesse into doing whatever he wants. More weird nightmares would follow. The next night, he found Freddy's glove moving on its own in the drawer, and even dreamt of his own sister jump roping while singing the Freddy Krueger nursery rhyme. In the morning, their toaster catches fire, even though it's not plugged in. Dad, what about the bird that exploded yesterday? In the evening, Freddy possesses Jesse's body again, and he visits his sister's room. But when he speaks out to her, Freddy's voice comes out.
Wake up, little girl.
So then, she does wake up, clearly sees her brother standing there, and asks what time it is. And when he tells her, it's in Jesse's voice again, because she's no longer asleep.
It's late. Go back to sleep.
So which one is it? You want her to wake up or go to sleep? Make up your mind. Now, up until this point, Freddy has kind of been able to fly under the radar. Some of his victims drew a big police presence, but because he only takes one victim at a time, and because all of his victims are asleep, there are only a couple witnesses who know that he's behind it. So that would all change soon, because Lisa Weber, a girl from Jesse's school who has a crush on him, holds a big pool party, and of course, invites Jesse. She tries to get it on with him in the cabana, but Freddy demonstrates his control by, once again, materializing a huge rotting tongue in the real world. For Jesse, this represents his true sexuality, which he's trying to hide. So when he realizes he's unable to control it, he gets out of it. Which is actually smart. Good job, Jesse. Except he goes to visit the boy he most likely has an eye on at Brady, which was not smart. Because as he's there, he literally sees himself transform into Freddy, which is an agonizing process for him. Jesse, or Freddy, it's not really clear which one Grady can actually see, puts on the fingerblade glove and gashes right through him as he bangs on the door for help. Rip Grady. With the floodgates now open for Freddy to manipulate stuff in the real world, he goes back to sabotage the pool party, locking everyone in, blowing up the lights, heating the pool to the point of boiling, and worst of all, setting all the hot dogs on fire. Meanwhile, inside, Freddy takes over Jesse's body and attacks Lisa. He starts eating her leg, for some reason. Okay. But she gets away and tries to call out to Jesse, believing that he's still in there somewhere. She actually gets through to him, but it's clear that he's given up hope.
Kill me, Lisa. Please kill me.
And since Freddy's only real goal is to kill people and harvest souls, he just finds this amusing. I heard a knock upon my door the other day. Natural reaction. Lisa stabs him in the shoulder, but even in the real world, that does no good. This is the same guy who used to cut himself all day for fun. He throws Lisa against the wall, but for now, he's gonna let her live. It's always hard for me to analyze his actions when they don't make any sense, but here goes. Freddy knew that Lisa loved Jesse, so he didn't see her as a threat and decided to go after the other guests at the pool party first. Everyone outside is confused by the commotion, then this happens. During this onslaught, nobody can escape because they're locked in and the fence is burning hot. Chaos ensues, the pool catches fire, and at least four teens are killed before Lisa's dad makes it outside with his gun. But knowing that Jesse is still in there somewhere, Lisa actually prevents him from firing at Freddy. I guess the decision to keep her alive paid off for him, at least in the short term. Perhaps realizing the situation, though, like that he could potentially get shot and die in the real world, he just walks to the edge of the party and bursts into flames. Nightmare 2 makes no sense. I tried, okay? He goes back to his old base of operations, the boiler room, at the now-abandoned power plant, but soon finds that he's not alone. It isn't long before Freddy realizes he has a visit. Lisa is still determined to get back her friend and crush, Jesse, so Freddy stalks her from afar and tortures her with a series of hallucinations before aggressively appearing before her and nearly slicing her face open. He's about to finish her off when Lisa hears Jesse's voice and confesses her love for him. And this actually seems to physically hurt Freddy. For example, the spot that she stabbed him in earlier starts bleeding. And the more she says she loves him, the more pain he seems to be in. Lisa kisses him, and Freddy goes up in flames. His skin burns away, and he turns back into Jesse. Sticking with the sexuality metaphor, this is Jesse taking back hold of his ability to repress his feelings. He knows he'll hurt Lisa if he comes out. He knows people in his life will be ashamed of him. That's just the reality of the time period he lives in. So he's got to get control of it, and in a literal sense, he gets control of Freddy, the hidden monster that is manipulating his actions. But like Nancy 5 years before, the victory is only temporary, and before Jesse goes back to school, he dreams of another runaway bus, where Freddy's hand bursts out of the classmate's chest and presumably makes good on his earlier promise and finishes him off. After 1986, the records of kids who died are not as well kept, because it seems like it's just become such a common thing that the school can't even keep up with it. We do find out about a kid in early 1987 who is most likely a Freddy victim.
We lost a kid about a month ago in Fairview.
I don't know where he got the razors, but he cut off his own eyelids to stay away.
That's funny, I did the same thing when I was trying to make it through watching the Nightmare on Elm Street remake. At some point, Freddy finished taking out most all of the kids with connections to the group of parents who killed him in 1968, but there were a few leftovers who no longer lived there. These kids survived their first encounters with Freddy, but still incurred injuries during their nightmares, which made it look like they had each attempted suicide. One example is Kristen Parker, most likely in spring 1987. Kristen dreamed that she was outside 1428 Elm Street and tried to save a little girl who wandered inside. As she tries to fend off Freddy in her dream, he manipulates things in the real world so that it looks like she slit her wrists. Her mom catches her and sends her to Weston Hill Psychiatric Hospital, where she joins several other kids who were deemed to be suicidal because of their encounters with Freddy. They were essentially held there against their will, but clearly they were lucky to be alive. There are pros and cons to this strategy. On one hand, he can continue to consume more souls while covering up each death as something else, meaning his victims will be less informed and less prepared to fight him. The downside is that the public doesn't credit him with each kill, and the town's belief in him and fear of him is part of what gives him power, as we saw with Nancy. And speaking of Nancy, Freddy's greatest rival would resurface as a therapist at Weston Hill. As a survivor, she's the only one who can help the kids who are trapped with them, because she's the only one who believes in them. During Kristen's next nightmare, she's attacked by a giant worm incarnation of Freddy, and she pulls Nancy into her dream. Nancy finds a glass shard and stabs the creature in the eye, allowing Kristen to get free. When Freddy sees Nancy's face, he recognizes her as the one who got away. Kristen was able to pull Nancy into her dream because of a unique ability she had, which would create a new challenge for the Springwood Slasher. Previously, he never really had to worry about his victims teaming up on him. The worst they could do was stand by to wake someone up if they sensed a nightmare. Kristen's ability made her especially dangerous, allowing the kids to fight back together. So Freddy got to work taking out each of her friends in their own individual dreams. One patient, Philip, is an amateur puppeteer, so Freddy enters his dream and turns him into a human puppet, using his veins as strings, marching him to a third floor window, and cutting him loose, causing him to fall to his death in both the dream and the real world. Probably the most disturbing and creative kill in all of Freddy's history. The next night, he goes after Jennifer, an aspiring TV star, and pulls her head through the TV in her room. During a group hypnosis session shortly after, a mute patient named Joey wanders away from the group when he's distracted by a nurse that he has a crush on. Wait, Joey, she's a trap! Yeah, it turns out to be Freddy, who shoves his giant tongue down the kid's throat, then uses it to restrain him above the bed, which falls away into a giant pit of fire. It's always the tongue with this guy. I swear, I could do a whole video on just the history of Freddy Krueger's tongue. We get flashbacks to the Grimace video at this point. It once again uses the two themes that I keep coming back to. Freddy is implied to be a predator through his actions, and he's associated with the devil by suspending Joey over what is essentially a pit to hell.
No! Not into the pit! It burns!
Meanwhile, all the other patients are together in the group session, discovering how they can be whoever they want to in their dreams.
In my dreams, I'm beautiful.
Okay. Whatever you say. Freddy traps them using the same tactic he used at the pool party the previous year. When they try to escape, they realize the doorknobs are burning hot. Kind of an inconsistency, because in the first movie, touching something hot will wake
come
you
up. On.
But maybe this is different because these kids are in hypnosis. The room transforms into an industrial silo-type thing, but luckily, a doctor discovers the sleeping group. However, because Joey was trapped by Krueger in the dream, he's unable to awaken, and he falls into a deep coma. It would be easy for him to just kill Joey at this point and take his soul, but Freddy wants revenge on Nancy for getting the best of him 6 years prior, and uses Joey as a hostage. Kristen pulls everyone into the dream world to save him, but they're immediately ambushed and sent into their own little breakout dream. Kristen dreams about her mother bringing home a guest, who turns out to be Freddy in a bow tie, but she's able to use some parkour moves to escape. Taryn finds herself in an alley, where she notices some graffiti that says Taryn plus Freddy enclosed in a heart. Once again, Freddy is inappropriately tying himself to these kids in a romantic context. This would continue throughout the rest of Freddy's history. He takes the form of a pin-up model, asks the girl if she wants to suck face, asks the girl if she wants to make babies, and even takes the form of another Freddy. Look, I'm not Chris Hansen, I'm not going to point out every single time he does something like this. You get the idea. Freddy starts to use each kid's weaknesses against them. Taryn is a former addict, so Freddy transforms his finger blades into syringes, which he plunges into her. Will is disabled in the real world. He can only walk in his dreams, so Freddy runs him down with what I can only describe as a giant BDSM wheelchair. He tries to conjure up some dream magic to destroy the chair and vanquish Freddy, but it's not enough to do anything.
Sorry, kid. I
It's cool to see Freddy evolving as a villain. In the beginning, he just terrorized Nancy and her friends with generic nightmare stuff. But now he's learned to tailor each nightmare towards whoever he's going after. The evolution fits nicely, because it makes it all that more important for the remaining survivors to team up if they want to have a chance against him. They have strength in numbers, because he can only tailor the nightmare to fit one person. But, unfortunately for the group, there is only one person that he wants more than anyone. And their showdown would be 6 years in the making. The group finds Joey in the boiler room, which looks even more like an underworld realm than ever before, with their friends suspended over an even deeper hellpit. Freddy confronts Nancy, who foolishly demands that he let Joey go, and she has to run to save him from falling into the pit. This gives Kruger the perfect opportunity to push her in, but her new friends come to her rescue. Kristen knocks him back with a flying jump tackle.
Okay, Angus is gonna knock down these chips using a flying jump tackle.
Like I said, flying jump tackle, and Kincaid smashes him over the head with a giant metal pipe. I also like how Kincaid's dream power is just him being strong, even though he already is strong in the real world. However, Kruger is able to stop him and lift him into the air with one arm while choking. But their teamwork continues to be their advantage, as Nancy finds a metal stake and thrusts it through Freddy's gut, which surprises him, but he simply laughs and pulls it out. Nancy comments on how he's never been this strong, and Freddy shows her why, by revealing the screaming souls of the children that give him strength. Meaning that with each victim he takes, he gets more and more powerful in the dream world. Keep that in mind, because it's going to explain some anomalies later. But even with this additional power, he's not able to finish off Kincaid, because he vanishes to go fight another battle. Apparently, he can only be in one place at a time, and he's got to go clash with one of the doctors from the hospital and Nancy's dad, who are together trying to bury his bones in the real world. They believe laying Freddy's bones to rest will end his curse. They're basically completely wrong about this, but for whatever reason, Freddy still wants to defend his bones, so he brings them to life and engages in combat as Skelly Freddy. Maybe the reason for this is because it was his one chance to finally get back at Nancy's dad, one of the parents who lynched him 19 years prior. And he does just that, throwing Donald into a stake and impaling him. He also manages to knock out the doctor and does a little celebratory emote. I actually had to do a double take right here, because I thought I was seeing actual footage of me whenever I have a video pop up. With that threat taken care of, Freddy returns to the dream world and freaks out the kids using a hall of mirrors, which very much needs to be a room if they ever do another Dream Warriors maze at horror nights. Each of them is pulled into a separate mirror, but Joey saves the day by springing out for the first time and shattering the glass to save them, which seems to hurt Freddy as well. But he has one more trick up his striped sleeve. This time, he takes the form of Nancy's father, as if he's entering the dream world to tell her that he's crossed over. And this honestly doesn't make sense. You're not dreaming if you're dead, but it's enough to trick Nancy into letting her guard down. He turns back into Freddy and stabs her in the stomach. It looks like it may be over for the rest of the Dream Warriors as well, but with the last of her strength, Nancy jumps on his back and drives his own finger blades into his chest. And for the first time, Freddy is beaten on his home turf. But in the end, Nancy's sacrifice would basically go in vain, because there's still a light on at 1428 Elm Street. The survivors, Kristen, Kincaid, and Joey, did get a little break from their Sprite Sweater Saboteur, but when they went back to school that fall, Kristen began to see signs of his return. Yes, this is Kristen now. She got a makeover, okay? She also got a boyfriend named Rick. I personally wouldn't be rushing out to date the new girl fresh out of a psychiatric hospital, but Rick doesn't seem to mind. In fact, they are so in love that they apparently don't notice this huge glowing slash in the lockers, more evidence of Freddy's imminent return. And that return would become a reality that evening, when Kincaid has a dream about the auto salvage where Freddy's bones were buried earlier that year. He sees his dog prodding at the burial spot and goes to take a piss, but instead emits a stream of flame, and Kincaid watches as crevices in the earth open up to make way for Freddy's reassembly. His flesh rots in reverse until his true hellish form is completely restored.
You shouldn't have buried me.
No, actually, he is dead, but as long as the dream demons still reside within him, he has the ability to come back and haunt more teenage dreams. So even when Kincaid pushes a car from above to crush him, he just respawns again. And eventually, Kincaid's luck runs out, and he gets a gut full of finger blades. So at this point, there's not much for me to analyze. It's pretty obvious that no amount of killing Freddy in the dream world will ever do away with him. And it would be some time before anyone else figures out how to bring him out into the real world. His immediate goal is to finish off the Elm Street children that managed to escape him at Weston Hill. After Kincaid, that continues with Joey, who is once again tricked by Freddy taking the form of his crush, this time a pin-up model from the poster, before he's pulled down into his water bed, kind of similar to what happened to Nancy in the bathtub. Kristen tries to dream about a place that Freddy would never go, and finds herself at the beach, but Freddy's glove emerges from the water like a shark did. Not even hitting land slows it down, and with a blast, she finds her worst nightmare standing before her with some pretty stylish shades, but not as stylish as my user space. Alice's choice of venue ends up working against her when Freddy manipulates the dream, turning beach sand into quicksand. But as Kristen sinks down, she emerges in a decayed Elm Street house and soon finds herself in the boiler room. Fittingly, he was chasing her to the spot where he had ended the lives of so many of the neighborhood's kids before her.
Elm Street's last breath.
And there's a good reason he allowed her to be the last survivor. He didn't want her to use her special ability to pull in any Dream Warrior reinforcements, as she had in the past. But due to her fear, she accidentally pulls someone into her dream anyway. This is Alice Johnson, Kristen's classmate and the sister of her boyfriend. Realizing her mistake, Kristen tries to shield the innocent Alice by attacking Freddy, but he effortlessly grabs her and hurls her into the raging furnace. Certainly one of the most brutal ways to go, since Freddy himself was burned. It's a moment of closure for him. The last link to the Elm Street families who killed him would go out the same way that he did. He proudly displays his collection of tortured souls in preparation for absorbing Kristen, but even in death, she proves to be visible. And instead of being absorbed by him, she passes through his body to Alice, in order to pass her dream powers on to her friend. Upon waking, Alice sees a new postcard on her mirror, greetings from hell. And as we've come to expect, Freddy is holding Kristen almost like a lover. Alice and Rick rush over to Kristen's house to find her room already in flames. It was too late to save her. So that was it. The Elm Street parents tried to get their revenge on Freddy, but in the end, he won, finishing off every last one of his descendants. But that didn't mean he was about to step away and quietly begin his retirement. And I can actually relate to this. When I first started getting serious about YouTube, my goal was to reach 10,000 subscribers. But when I did that, that silver plaque started looking not so out of reach, so I went for 100,000 subscribers. And when I got that, the glint of gold caught my eye, and I thought for sure I'd chill out after a million. And at first I did, but then I started to develop new goals, some of which you'll find out about in about a month. I think I've learned that if you have that drive to succeed, you're never going to be fully satisfied. And Freddy definitely had that drive. Maybe that's why the Dream Demons chose him. After eliminating the last of the Elm Street kids, he would broaden his hunt to the entire town of Spring. At Weston Hill, Freddy used each of the kids' weaknesses against them, so as he turned his attention to the entire city, he decided to have some fun and play with their fears as well. The first victim is Alice's asthmatic friend Sheila, who's worried about her astrology test. When she dozes off during it, Freddy sucks the oxygen out of her skull, causing her eyes to sink in and her skin to dry up. Rick is still struggling with grief over his girlfriend's death, and he apparently falls asleep on the toilet and sees Freddy use the form of Kristen to entice him before scaring the crap out of him.
I'll be right back. I'll leave this one.
Actually not intended, believe it or not. The bathroom stall turns into an elevator ride down to a Japanese dojo, which for some reason is decorated with an early prototype of the IGN logo. Rick's karate skills actually help him get the better of Freddy, but Krueger takes a cheap shot by launching his glove into his opponent before he can react. Alice's next dream features her getting sucked into the screen at a movie theater, which lands her at her place of work. Her biggest fear is waiting tables her entire life, so Freddy shows her imagery of an older version of herself still working there. But when he appears at the counter next to her, he doesn't try to kill her, and there's a reason for it, which is demonstrated when the older version of Alice brings him a pizza topped with meatballs resembling the souls of his victims. Because of her uncontrolled new ability to pull others into her dreams, Alice is essentially serving her friends right up to Freddy. And next in line is her friend Deb, whose greatest fear became cockroaches after she found one of her food earlier that week. Nobody showed her the body book, okay? During her workout sesh, she finds she has an unexpected spotter, who pushes her barbell down and snaps her elbows. Roach-like appendages jut out from her broken arms, and she slowly turns into an insect, and finds that she's a prisoner in a giant bug shroud. It's a new twist on the commonly reported nightmare of running in slow motion, which we saw before with Nancy and Kristen. Freddy watches through a small hole as she becomes her own worst nightmare, then crushes her inside the Roach Motel. He also does something that we've never seen him do before. In order to prevent Alice and her love interest, Dan, from interfering, he puts them in an infinite loop where they meet up at the diner, then go to save Deb, but just keep resetting back to the diner where they have to start all over again. What they're experiencing is another representation of a real-world sleep phenomena known as a false awakening. Most people have experienced this to some extent. You're dreaming, and then you wake up and start going through your morning routine, then you actually wake up and realize it was all a dream. For most, this will only happen once, but for others, it can happen like 10 times, hence the name false awakening. As with everything related to dreams, we only have theories about why this happens, no hard scientific conclusions. For normal people, it's often associated with anxiety for an important event, like a job interview, or, like, Halloween. That's an important event. In Alice's case, she may be stressed out about saving her friend. Others have suggested that small noises or interruptions can interrupt your REM sleep without fully waking you up, causing your dreams to reset to something familiar. Another theory is the proto-consciousness theory, which is basically the idea that your brain is trying to prepare you for the real world by showing you a dream similar to your reality. This obviously wouldn't apply to Alice, because she's not the only one manipulating her dreams. There's evidence to suggest a link between false awakenings and lucid dreams. Lucid dreams are just when you're dreaming, but you know that you're dreaming. So the false awakening could be your brain trying to trick you into thinking that you're not dreaming. This is much more likely what's going on with Alice and Dan. Each time the dream resets, they don't realize that they're dreaming until several repetitions in, when they finally figure it out. Again, I have to give credit to the movie Inception for conceptualizing this so well. The protagonist, Cobb, is essentially a professional lucid dreamer. He uses totems to help him determine if he's dreaming or not. But there's a chilling concern that rises throughout the movie that he may be getting lost in an infinite dream without realizing it. Personally, I find that idea more haunting than Freddy Krueger ever could be. But in Alice and Dan's case, they do escape from the dream when Freddy breaks the loop by appearing in the middle of the road. Alice tries to vehicular manslaughter him, but when she crashes into him, it's like hitting a baller, and the truck is crushed like a can. They wake up, realizing they've crashed into a tree. Dan is rushed to the hospital, where he's put under and has to deal with the dreams about Freddy Krueger as a surgeon, but Alice is okay, and intentionally goes to sleep so she can try to enter his dream and save him. She's able to stall long enough for Dan to wake up, thus making him disappear from the dream to safety, which should technically be the end of the dream, because it was his dream to begin with, I think. But in light of the constantly changing rules in the Elm Street franchise, the nightmare continues, and Alice finds herself in a church, face-to-face with the devil himself. She fully realizes her title as the Dream Master by combining all of her friend's talents to fight Freddy. She uses Kristen's gymnastics, Rick's karate, Debbie's strength, and Sheila's technology. But, as we've seen before, Freddy can easily heal himself. And this is true. It's very well established that you can't kill Freddy in the dream world. But what Alice does is essentially the next best thing. Using a broken shard of stained glass, she forces him to look at his reflection, and he sees all of the screaming souls of his victims trapped inside of him. This causes him immense pain. Alice hits him with a blast of light, and an arm bursts out from within him as the souls of the dead attempt to climb their way out of his confines. The very souls that gave him power are now keeping him pinned down against the trellis. And finally, his face bursts open, allowing each of them to escape freely into the night, thanking Alice for finally ending their suffering. Although Freddy's skin, his sweater, and his glove are left in a heap on the ground, and things do go back to normal for a short while, it's only a matter of time before the nightmares would return. Shortly before her high school graduation, in June 1989, Alice would begin seeing visions in her dreams detailing the conception and birth of Freddy Krueger at the insane asylum. The last of these dreams shows him being reborn and growing up into his former glory. When she wakes up, there's one thing she's most confused about.
It was Krueger. It happened while I was awake. Do you understand what I'm saying?
How could Freddy be terrorizing her dreams if she wasn't even asleep? This was a sly move by the Fedora Fatality Framer. Yes, I'm running out of ways to introduce this character. As you can see, we've been going for quite a while now. It was not her dreams that were playing host to Freddy, but rather the dreams of her unborn son, who Freddy had found while hiding out inside her. She did not know it yet, but Dan had gotten her pregnant, and according to this one doctor later in the movie, an unborn fetus spends up to 70% of its time dreaming. Since it is literally my job to overthink everything, I did do that once again. I looked at a number of articles, which all seem to agree that while we don't know for sure, it is likely that fetuses can dream. And I think that's believable, but my issue isn't about whether they can dream or not, it's the idea that they would be able to dream up scenes of the outside world. I imagine fetus dreams would be more of a series of sounds, temperature shifts, and other sensory changes. However, we do know that Krueger has the ability to manipulate dreams, so maybe he's able to introduce a visual aspect. Keep that in mind. But once again, this is all just theoretical. As with everything I've talked about in this video related to dream science. Because we have technology that can measure brain activity, but we don't have any tech that can record dreams as the dreamer sees them. And when it comes to remembering our dreams, our memories are very unreliable. Even if you remember your dream, you probably don't remember all of it. The hippocampus, the part of our brains that's responsible for storing memory, is not fully active during sleep, and it takes some time to get going after you wake up. That's why it's so easy to forget about your dream if you don't write it down right away. That could be why nightmares are oftentimes more memorable than dreams. Nightmares simulate danger, causing our survival instincts to kick in and wake up the hippocampus. But going off memory is still pretty unreliable for those trying to study dreams. So
how was everybody today?
Dreams, we'll likely never know what a fetus sees while it's dreaming. Which for now is good news if you're Freddy Krueger, who would continue his spree with a set of new victims. Despite losing some of his power a couple years earlier, Freddy is still well-equipped to dish out chaos in the dreams of Springwood's teenage population. He finally gets to Dan, who's pulled into a dream while driving and crashes his car. Although he survives, he has the bright idea of switching to a motorcycle, which is hijacked by a very Terminator-like Freddy and sent out of control into oncoming traffic. Next, he goes for members of Alice's new friend group. Greta is a student whose mother is pushing her to become a model, often criticizing her for her diet. Freddy pulls her into a dream during a dinner party and force feeds her to the point of asphyxiation. Mark is a comic book artist who is suddenly possessed to draw 1428 Elm Street. He's pulled into his own drawing and nearly sucked into the birth canal where Freddy is hiding, but Alice gets there in time to save him. Yvonne, a member of the diving team, also has a close call at practice when the diving board below her breaks apart and the pool transforms into this puddle that transports her to what appears to be the inside of the boiler. She's seized by Freddy, but Alice once again comes to the rescue, impaling Freddy through the mouth with the wrong end of a pool knife. All the while, Alice experiences several dreams featuring a young boy named Jacob, who she eventually comes to realize is a representation of her unborn son when she's pulled into a dream inside her own womb during an ultrasound and sees Freddy feeding the souls that he's collected to the baby.
He's taking their souls, their spirits. Making the baby like you.
I know we should probably be past the point of questioning when the rules of the Elm Street universe change, but seriously, does the baby dream about the real world or does the baby dream about the womb? Just pick one. The next victim is Mark, who is just kicking back and reading some comic books, but discovers that Freddy has taken over the cages with scenes of his friends being attacked. Once again, he's pulled into the world of the comic. He takes a page from the Dream Warriors by demonstrating a unique dream ability and turns himself into one of his superpowered characters. But Freddy does the same, emerging in this comic book villain-looking costume and referring to himself as Super Freddy. I guess we can give this one points for creativity, but it really feels like Freddy, and by extension, the creators of these movies, kind of forgot to try to be scary at some point, and it certainly doesn't help when Mark loses his three-dimensional volume and Freddy simply shreds him into scrap paper. However, I am still highly anticipating Paper Freddy in the Thousand-Year Door. With Yvonne and Alice as the two remaining survivors, Yvonne goes to look for the lost remains of Amanda Krueger, while Alice goes to sleep to confront Freddy before he can do any more damage to her baby. She finds herself in the corridors of the asylum, where she's chased but manages to lose him, then comes out of nowhere and rams him with his giant spiked baby stroller. Swaths of teenagers, as well as kids as young as 6 or 7 years old. Some of them turned up in strange places, like the side of a highway, while others just seemed to go missing. One by one, Freddy did what he had never been able to do before. With no Nancy Thompson, Kristen Parker, or Alice Johnson to stop him, he took out the entire population of kids and teenagers in Springwood, with just one kid who managed to escape. The remaining adults in town experienced some kind of mass psychosis, continuing to operate carnivals, schools, and other experiences designed for kids, while seeming not to notice, or at least not to acknowledge, that there are no kids anywhere.
Oh, what beautiful, adorable children! Would you like to come and live with us?
We should burn her alive next. As I mentioned, there was one survivor, and his name was John Doe.
What's in the box?
No, not that John Doe. No, it's not a placeholder name. His parents just f***ed him. Then again, my parents love me, yet they still named me Zach Morris in the 90s. And speaking of the 90s, A Nightmare on Elm Street skips over them. At the beginning of Freddy's Dead, The Final Nightmare, a title says the events take place 10 years from now. The movie came out in 1991, meaning that Freddy's next activity would be set in 2001. This discarded newspaper says April 22 on it, so let's call it April 2001. I guess Freddy was trying to tie up loose ends by killing John so he could enjoy Shrek and Weezer's Green Album in peace the following month. John is taken on a wild dream where he's sucked out of an airplane, experiences a false awakening, and sees Freddy, dressed up as a Wizard of Oz witch, zooming around his house, which is in freefall. I guess Freddy's having some fun with this one. to celebrate his last Springwood victim. The house lands at 1427 Elm Street, the very spot where Kruger took the life of Glenn Burns 20 years before. But John survives and hightails out to a Greyhound station where Kruger strikes him with a bus, which he also survives. John is brick-eated through a tearing reality back into the waking world, which has literally never been a thing before. When Freddy touches this portal, it closes on him, and he says this.
Now be a good dog.
Like Alice and Jacob before him, John is being kept alive as part of Freddy's plan. This time, he's trying to use him to get to his own biological daughter, Catherine, who is now in her 40s and working as a psychiatrist in the shelter for troubled kids in a neighboring town. Why he needs John to do this is completely unclear, since he is very capable of leaving the boundaries of Springwood, but that is the explanation he gives. John and Catherine drive back into town to find answers to the mysteries of their past. Three other kids from the shelter still away: Carlos, Tracy, and Spencer. Although these three are not from Springwood, that does not save them from the wrath of Freddy Krueger. The three runaways end up spending the night at 1428 Elm Street. Even though it looks totally different now, where Carlos is the next one to learn why there aren't any kids in Spring. He dreams that Tracy is calling his name and turns a corner to find himself in some kind of
fucking go up
where
there.
His mom threatens to clean out his ears, which may or may not be related to the reason that Carlos wears a hearing.
All right.
The mom reveals herself to be none other than Freddy and sticks a giant cotton swab through his head. Somehow this doesn't kill him, so Freddy then throws him through a brick wall, or at least some wallpaper of a brick wall. How hard would it have been to just make some foam bricks? All I know is that Carlos ends up in the boiler room.
Alright, even on medium, this shit is fucking hard.
During this era, Freddy seems to spend less time killing and more time having fun with his victims. We don't know when his last kill was, but maybe he's just enjoying torturing this group because he hasn't had a victim in so long. Also, provided that he's been collecting souls this whole time, we can assume that he's extremely powerful now. So, messing around would literally only serve for entertainment purposes. So, Freddy does just that. But just like the time he complied with Nancy's request to let her friend go, his compliance comes with unintended side effects. Carlos's hearing aid turns into this little parasitic creature and amplifies the sound way too much, to the point that dropping a pin would drive him insane. Then, he threatens to drop a handful of pins, and Carlos screams, begging him to stop. Which makes no sense because of the simple fact that you can hear your own voice and this would be way louder than the pins dropping. Look, it's been a long video. My explanation is that this is just dream art.
It's a bad run.
This, Freddy gives him the old nails on the chalkboard routine, and his head explodes. Meanwhile, Spencer, the stoner character of the group, falls asleep on the couch and sees this anti-drug PSA on TV. But Freddy knocks out the host with a frying pan and hypnotizes Spencer into a psychedelic music video. We've seen Freddy use a similar tactic before, with Alice getting sucked into a movie and Mark into a comic book. I know I've had dreams where I start off watching a show, but then gradually find that I'm a character in that show. But strangely, when I tried looking this up to see if it was a common phenomenon, I couldn't find anyone who shared my experience. The closest thing I found was people reporting about fictional characters entering their world, but nothing about the dreamer entering the fictional world. In Spencer's case, he ends up inside of a video game.
My life is like a video game.
Thank you, Ronnie. As he's manipulated by Freddy in the game world, his body mimics those movements in the real world, leading to him being aerated through a painting. Oh my god, Spencer, are you okay? Do you need to go to the hospital? Freddy repeatedly stomps on him in the game, then makes him go full cartoon and basically destroys the house. At this point, John and Catherine have shown up, and John wants to enter the dream world to try to save him. There are so many problems with this. So let's talk about it. One, John doesn't really even know Spencer. Two, the reason that characters have been able to enter other characters' dreams before is because of the special ability passed from Kristen to Alice to Jacob. Nobody here is shown to have that ability. They shouldn't even be able to get into Spencer's dream. Three, John enters the dream world by asking Tracy to knock him unconscious. Being unconscious is not the same as being asleep. You aren't dreaming when you're unconscious. Your brain is basically shut down. But ignoring all of that, they discover Freddy enjoying his video game like a delighted 8-year-old on Christmas morning. So Tracy unplugs his control. This does very little, though, because in this dream, Freddy's glove doubles as a power glove, which, if you don't know what that is, it was a special controller used for the Nintendo Entertainment System in 1989 that allowed you to control certain games with hand movements. Freddy uses it to shut Tracy and John out and take control of Spencer's body, tossing him down the stairs and into a bottomless pit. Catherine tries to gather Tracy and John and get the hell out of Springwood, but as John is still asleep in the back of the van, he dreams that he's in freefall once more. But Freddy has stowed away in his parachute. He reveals that Catherine is his daughter, and that he only kept John alive to get with her. So he cuts him down from the parachute, and also comically wheels in a bed of spikes from the land up. Because I guess just going splat on the ground wouldn't have been painful enough. Freddy absorbs his soul, and back at the shelter, nobody remembers the three boys ever existed, other than Doc, a therapist who works there and specializes in dream therapy.
He just killed Chris because he
was. I mean, he's never done that before, but sure, add it to the list of rules that have changed. Catherine and Tracy are each tormented with dreams of an abusive father, but survive. In Tracy's case, she tries to fight back with martial arts, prompting Freddy to say this.
This, bitch!
Sorry, I had to take a minute. Alright, who wrote this line? Michael DeLuca. So after that lady from the carnival, my proposal is that we burn him next. Alright, I gotta get through this. So Doc has his own encounter with Freddy and fights him off with a bat, which is laughable for him at this point.
Dreams. Forever!
Which has the exact same energy as one of the best lines in screenwriting history from Mortal Kombat Annihilation. Anyway, the Freddy, I'm losing it, Kruger's making me lose it. The doctor manages to rip off a piece of Freddy's sweater right before his alarm goes off and realizes that he brought the fabric out of the dream with him. This is really important because it gives him the idea to bring Freddy back out into the real world where he may be mortal, something that nobody has attempted to do since Jesse and Lisa fought Freddy in the real world in 1986. So Freddy is vulnerable for the first time in 15 years. They divide the plan and Catherine goes into the dream with the intention of bringing the bastard son of 100 maniacs out with her. This dream takes her to the Temple of Morpheus, where she passes the dream demons and symbolically enters Freddy's brain, where she sees all of his memories and comes to the realization that the Springwood Slasher is none other than her Springwood father. And he's not happy about her breaking her promise to keep quiet. Catherine and Freddy scuffle, and she does manage to grab onto him, but he spawns in another room in the real world. At first, he appears to be human again, no longer sporting the burn scars and seemingly able to feel pain. It's never really explained, but I'm guessing this was all just part of the ruse, because when he sees Catherine, he tries to convince her that all of the horrible things he did weren't his fault because of the abuse he suffered as a kid. He's trying to play to her sympathetic side, because she's worked with so many troubled kids and felt pity for them, but what I think he's overlooking is that she was in an abusive household herself as a child, and she doesn't turn out like Freddy. She's a functioning member of society. We talk a lot about the connection between early trauma and, well, villainy here on this channel, but it's important to remember that going through stuff in your youth doesn't guarantee anything. You always have some control in your own destiny. So Catherine doesn't fall for his bit, whacks him with a nail-spiked bat, and then knocks the finger blade blood off his hand. She's a switch hitter, and she's got some serious exit here. Kruger, who somehow now has his hat back, somehow climbs onto the ceiling. Does he now have the ability to manipulate things and use his dream powers in the real world? I have a theory about that, which we'll get to. Freddy goes in for the kill, bragging that he didn't need the glove to kill her mother. She's able to headbutt her way free, and then she repeatedly slashes him in the face, with each strike in honor of someone close to her whose life he had taken. You know, for someone who just said that he doesn't need the glove, he sure seems like he wants the glove. The fight, and possession of the glove, goes back and forth, but in the end, it is Catherine who ends up with it, and he actually encourages her to try it out for science. He seems to think that wearing the glove is going to make her evil or something, but that's not what happened. She stabs him in the stomach, then Tracy tosses her a lit stick of dynamite that they just have, and Catherine lodges it into him. His last word is, kids, before he blows up, finally killing him in the real world, finally releasing the dream demons within him, and finally putting an end to the curse of Freddy Krueger that plagued Springwood for the better part of 4 decades. But if Freddy had the ability to use his dream abilities in the real world, how could he ever really die? My theory is that he didn't. In fact, I'm not convinced that any of this even happened. We've seen Freddy use false awakenings to trick someone into thinking they've woken up, when in fact they're actually still in the dream world. It happened to Kristen, Alice, and John, so who's to say that it didn't happen again with Hatcher? What if this whole sequence where she wakes up and kills Freddy in the real world wasn't in the real world at all? We never see any follow-up on any of these characters, so I have to assume that's what happened. But even if he came out victorious against Catherine, Tracy, and Doc, he still had a problem. As stated early in this video, he uses the fear of children and teens to give him the power to invade dreams. And Springwood officials seem to realize this at some point. It's probably because there are no kids in the entire town, and rumors of Freddy Krueger invading people's dreams stopped popping up. Those who had been around long enough could have just made the connection and figured out how he operates. And at some point, these survival stories of the few who escaped, like Dr. Gordon, Alice, Yvonne, and possibly Catherine, Tracy, and Doc, would have started to sound more believable. So the powers that be who came to believe in Freddy Krueger took steps to ensure that he could never come back and slice through the town again. Anyone who mentioned Krueger's name would get an unfortunate diagnosis and be sentenced to treatment at Weston Hill Psychiatric Hospital, where a steady dose of the dream suppressant medication Hypnocell would be administered. This is the same experimental medication that Nancy used between 1981 and 1987 to stay off of Freddy's radar, and it's likely that Dr. Gordon had something to do with implementing this policy, along with Springwood Police. They even went back and scrubbed the public record, removing and redacting anything about Krueger and his victims. Eventually, families forgot about Springwood's curse and started moving into town again, having babies and repopulating the youth. But this new generation didn't know about the horror that plagued the town three millennia, so they weren't afraid. There were a few hiccups along the way, like Bobby Davis and Mrs. Campbell, but all of the deaths were staged as accidents or suicide by police, and anyone heard spouting off rhetoric about Krueger was shipped off to Weston Hills and cut off from contact with the outside world. As a result, Freddy lost the power to dream crash, and for the first time, found himself stuck on the outside. Before long, Freddy would make a plea with one of his contemporaries. Enter Jason Voorhees. Born in the mid-1900s in Crystal Lake, New Jersey, Jason was nearly drowned by the other kids one year at summer camp. He should have been supervised, but the counselors were off having filthy sex. So just like Freddy, Jason had a disdain for kids and teenagers, and every now and then, he would come back to life and kill someone. Jason was defeated by his niece, Jessica Campbell, and dragged down into hell, leaving his iconic hockey mask behind. It is then that Freddy re-emerges and grabs the mask, hoping to make a preposition towards the Crystal Lake killer. After 4 years of silence, Freddy had a game plan to get back in action.
Listen to me. We do things around here certainly for a reason. And that's given us 4 years of peace.
Meaning that it was summer of 2005, when Freddy, most likely using the last reserves of his remaining power, takes the form of Jason's mother, Pamela Voorhees, and instructs him to wake up and go to Elm Street to strike fear into the kids now living there. Jason is immortal and can come back to life as many times as he pleases, and Freddy's plan is to have him kill and spark concerns in the town that Freddy is a killer, which would give him back some of his power. Jason makes the long walk to Springwood, and his first kill is a teenager in the upstairs bedroom at 1428 Elm Street, which is now restored to more or less how it's supposed to look. This prompts some troubling deja vu from two senior officers.
Jesus. It's even the same damn house.
And that's all it takes to get the old Freddy Fear Train rolling again. A teen named Lori Campbell overhears the officer say Krueger's name, and she becomes the first person to become vulnerable to him once again. In her dream, she meets Freddy's last casualty before the fire, a little girl with empty eyes on her, who cautions her that Freddy will soon be strong enough to come back and suggests that she warns people. This is obviously Freddy, trying to spook her so she can cause hysteria in the real world and make the town afraid of him. That same night, he feels confident enough to make his return and attacks a boy named Blake using a giant shadow version of himself. But the slash goes right through him. Freddy has not yet regained enough of his power to make an impact, so he sits back and lets Jason do his thing. After hearing about the new murders, two Weston Hills patients, Will and Mark, escape and end up spreading even more hysteria about Freddy. They think that they're helping prepare people, but in reality, they're adding to Freddy's power. Lori's best friend, Kia, has a nightmare where he appears in a catalog that she's flipping through and slices her nose off. But because he's not back to full strength yet, nothing manifests in the real world. But by that evening, the fear-powered adrenaline that powered him through the 80s and 90s pumps through and surges once again. Freddy is ready to make his comeback, but there's one thing he didn't take into account. Freddy's next attempt comes that night. During a cornfield dance party, he appears to get the girlfriend of Jason's first Springwood victim, taking the form of her recently deceased boyfriend to lure her to asylum. Once inside, she finds herself trapped in Freddy's favorite location, the boiler room. Before killing her, he puts his own twist on a famous quote.
The only thing to be is fear.
The original quote, "The only thing to fear is fear itself," was said by U.S. President Franklin D. Roosevelt in his inauguration speech during the Great Depression. The quote was credited with inspiring many Americans to regain faith in themselves and pull through the economic downturn. The last 4 years for Freddie have been like his own personal Great Depression. He hasn't haunted the nightmares of any kids, nor has he reaped any souls. But now, he's pulling through, and the teams of Springwood have something to fear again. Yeah, Freddy versus Jason. Do you have any thoughts? Gib hides in the locker, but just before Freddy gets her, a wound in her chest bursts open on its own, because Jason, operating from the real world, got there first.
Jason,
Mom,
I
There's also an interesting parallel going on. Freddy and Jason's feud begins because Jason moves in on the girl that he wanted to kill first. The main character this time, Lori, is also caught between two boys. Tension arises because Charlie had his eyes on her, but her old boyfriend, Will, reemerges after escaping Weston Hills, and he had her first. Like I said, Freddy vs. Jason, these are the new thoughts. Mark, the other Weston Hills escapee, falls asleep at his desk, and with no hypnosis to suppress his dreams, he drifts off to a scene in his bathroom, where Freddy appears in the mirror, then haunts him using the form of his dead brother. He traps Mark in place, using barbed tendrils to tie down his feet. At first, he's willing to keep Mark alive in exchange for sending a message about Freddy's comeback to the waking world. But Mark understands his plan and refuses to help Krueger reach more victims. So Freddy, perhaps realizing that Mark's friends have arrived outside his window, decides to send the message himself, lighting the boy on fire and tossing him around the room in a manner similar to how he once used Tina Gray to instill fear in that early generation of Elm Street kids. He finishes Mark with a slash to the face and a message burnt into his flesh. Freddy's back. Well, no, that's Mark's back, technically. You just inscribed a message over it. Meanwhile, the Springwood Police Department is already hard at work trying to contain Freddy Krueger based on what they've learned from past cases, but not realizing that Jason Voorhees is also on the loose this time. They quarantine the town, hoping to stop the spread of talk about Freddy. Meanwhile, Lori Campbell and a group of other survivors are the first to realize that Freddy and Jason are basically in a turf war. Lori dozes off as they're discussing their options and has a nightmare where Freddy takes the form of her father and tries to kiss her. Lucky for her, she's woken up by the others just in time and even pulls Freddy's ear out of the dream with her. But Freddy continues to track the group as they head back to Weston Hills. There, a stoner character named Bill gets a little too sleepy, and Freddy uses the opportunity to manipulate him in his dreams, making him eat this giant parasite thing, and in the real world, pour all of the hypnosil down the drain. Freddy's deductive reasoning skills here are pretty impressive. I don't believe he can see everything going on in the real world. If he could, then he would have been able to see Nancy's booby traps. But when he saw that Bill was at Weston Hills, he made the connection, figured out their plan, and thwarted it. He also uses this opportunity to get back at Jason, who had shown up to try to steal another one of his kills. Freddy takes over Bill's body and sedates him using a tranquilizer known as Immobitine, because every medication in this facility has extremely obvious names. Unfortunately for him, this gives Jason enough time to chop Bill in half before he can devour the soul. From Freddy's point of view, it's probably a worthwhile sacrifice. He got rid of the hypnosil and pacified his new rival. Earlier, I mentioned how it didn't make sense for a character to dream while knocked out cold, but this is different. It's understood to be possible to dream while sedated, even under anesthesia. So, for the first time, Jason finds himself in the old boiler. Using the appearance of Mrs. Voorhees, Freddy scolds Jason for not returning back home after filling out his routine, then reveals himself as Freddy Krueger. And the two icons clash head-to-head for the first time. Being that Freddy can't take damage...
Collision detection is kind of wonky.
And he also air-geeks Jason a bunch of times, which is pretty fun.
Plasma rifle or,
Freddy loves air-geeting Jason, and really all of their surroundings during this fight.
Do this before. It's hard to plasma gun is really nice.
That he's developed, or if he's always been able to do this, and this time he's just keeping his distance, because he knows that Jason poses more of a threat than the average Springwood final. Whatever the reason may be, the part where he freaking sends Jason across the room by air-humping has got to be one of the most underappreciated moments of all time. Like, if you type air-humping Freddy into YouTube, the only results you get are Fred Jones and Freddy Fazbear. And for some reason, permanent. But even dropping a water tank on Jason doesn't do him in, which starts to frustrate his nightmarish opponent, but it does lead to him discovering Jason's greatest fear, water. It causes him to revert back to that trembling little boy at Crystal Lake, and Freddy dives deeper into his subconscious. Pun not intended, again, surprisingly. He's taken back to Jason's childhood, the moment the other kids threw him in the lake. Lori enters the dream, hoping to bring Krueger out with her, the idea being that Jason could kill Freddy in the real world and hopefully not come back to Springwood. But before she can save young Jason from a watery grave, Freddy emerges and pulls him under even deeper. Timing is not on his side there, and Jason's tranquilizer wears off, waking him up and banishing him from the nightmare. In a rage, he turns his fury to Lori, who tries to pull him out of the dream, but thanks to another false awakening, finds herself in her own nightmare, where the truth is revealed about Freddy being the one who killed her mother. After taking her out, he comes after Lori, but once again, time is not on his side. And it would probably help if he just killed his victims as soon as he got the chance, instead of just hovering over them and talking to them for 2 minutes, but that's not what he does. The two awake in a flaming cabin in Camp Crystal Lake, with Jason marching towards them in a rage. Being in the real world, Jason poses a real threat to Freddy now. And, like the Milwaukee Brewers anytime they have to play my Cubs, he's also lost his home field advantage. Their epic battle tears the cabin apart, but somehow, Freddy sneaks away from the chaos to try to nab Lori and her friends before they can get away. I like to think that he realizes that he's no match for Jason in the real world, and needs their soul power to buff him up to take on his master powers. However, it's not long until Jason finds him, and steals yet another one of his victims, and the two duke it out some more. The fight finds its way to a construction site, where Freddy launches gas tank torpedoes, releases metal stakes, and manages to get them both struck by a runaway storage car. But Jason is a relentless machine, and Freddy continues to find ways to fight back. It probably could have gone on forever, but in the end, Lori and her boyfriend Will douse the dock in propane and come back with torches, setting the dock ablaze and triggering a massive explosion. Just as he had during his first trip through the real world, Freddy is torched by Elm Street residents, but this time it's only briefly. He falls into the lake, extinguishing the flames, and shortly after comes for the two surviving teens with Jason's machete. But with the last of his energy, Jason stabs him through the back with his own finger-bladed arm, giving Lori the opportunity to avenge her fallen mother and friends with one clean, decapitating slice. At long last, Nancy Thompson's original goal of killing Freddy in the real world has been achieved. But is this truly the end of Freddy Krueger? The evidence would suggest no, as the last thing we see is Jason emerging from the lake with the dismembered Freddy head in hand. But he seems to have the same unrelenting ability to survive in this world as he did in the nightmarescape of his many victims. Remember to subscribe to CZ's World for new horrors every week, ring the death bell for notifications, and I'll see you in the next one. Assuming we both survive.
Food! I want food!
Recording the Freddy video. I think it'll be pretty good. There were definitely parts that were less fun to talk about than others. Well, because the fun part is analyzing the character. Some of those later sequels, not a whole lot of substance to talk about, really. Honestly, pretty hard to get through. Freddy vs. Jason is surprisingly deep, though. Yeah, I don't know. The one problem that I kept running into was the rules are constantly changing from movie to movie. It does kind of feel like something's missing.
All of the coast. The USGS is reporting a magnitude 4.2 earthquake on the coast of Baton, California.
All right, so around the outside we go.
But I've come to realize the answer is right there. It's because in Nightmare on Elm Street, Freddy's Revenge, Dream Warriors, The Dream Master, The Dream Child, Freddy's Dead, and Freddy vs. Jason are technically movies within a franchise. They're just movies made to entertain characters in a movie. They weren't made to be inspected that closely. It's not that different from when I inspect newspaper headlines about Freddy's kidnappings, but the articles themselves talk about baseball scores,
Frederick!
And Marine Corps movements. The real world of this franchise is actually the world where actors like Heather Langenkamp and Robert Englund star in the Nightmare on Elm Street movies in Hollywood. Mrs. Langenkamp's son even takes a shot at the increasingly unbelievable logic seen in some of the Elm Street sequels.
Can you come with me, Charles? I think that only happens in the movie.
In terms of the timeline, this takes place in the modern day of when New Nightmare came, which is 1994, after Freddy's Dead, but before Freddy vs. Jason.
So Heather approaching her 10th anniversary. This whole Nightmare on Elm Street.
The horror is set in motion when Wes Craven, the director of the original Nightmare on Elm Street, starts developing an idea for a revival of the franchise. Even he isn't fully in control of the script. script, claiming that he just waits for scary dreams to come to him and then he writes them down and incorporates them. He describes a nightmare entity so ancient that it's existed in many different forms and cultures. The only ones that can capture it are storytellers. It was captured for the last decade in the Nightmare on Elm Street franchise, but when the series ended, it was set free.
He's sort of gotten used to being Freddy now, so he likes our time and space, so decided to cross over. Out of films.
After he begins writing, Heather begins receiving ominous phone calls from a stalker with a Freddy Krueger voice, repeating the lines of the in-universe nursery rhyme, which weighs heavily on her and freaks out her son, Dylan. She also receives a series of troubling letters burned into book pages in the lab. One day, she has a dream. The animatronic Freddy glove used in a new Nightmare on Elm Street movie seems to come to life on its own and massacres the crew members on set before coming for her son. At first, she believes the nightmare was triggered by an earthquake, but would soon come to suspect a much darker explanation. During one talk show interview, the host surprises Heather with an appearance from her Nightmare co-star, Robert Englund, complete with the Freddy makeup and costume. She plays along, but she's clearly pretty uncomfortable because of what she's going through in her personal life.
So you're actually pretty, fairly highly maneuverable, in this game.
Which is the final line from the Freddy Krueger nursery rhyme, a movie that she had forbidden him from watching. She also discovers a four-fingered slash through one of his toys, causing her to start to suspect Freddy Krueger may be crossing over into the real world. Later that night, Dylan expresses a belief that Rex keeps away the meal and out of the clock. She insists that there's nothing under his bed, but it's hard to tell if she's trying to convince him or trying to convince herself. This is also a reversal of the circumstances from her role as Nancy Thompson in Nightmare on Elm Street. In that movie, she believed in Freddy, but had a hard time getting any support from any parents or authority figures. Now, she's in the position of a parent, grappling with whether to leave her own kid at risk of giving in to hysteria. After hearing about Dylan's episode, his father, Chase, a special effects artist doing pre-production for the new Nightmare movie, attempts to rush home from the location, but ends up passing out during the long drive. Or at least getting drowsy enough to enter that state of hypnagogic hallucination, the same way that Nancy did as her body started to shut down near the end of the Nightmare on Elm Street. Freddy's arm emerges from Chase's seat and stabs him in the chest, sending him barreling into a wall. Apparently they didn't show him the same documentary that my class was shown in film school to warn against the dangers of sleep deprivation. Say what you want about it, but that song was so annoying that it stuck, and nobody ever drove home drunk. As it often goes in the movies, Chase's injuries are attributed to damage caused by the vehicle, as it would be ridiculous to suspect a supernatural movie character. During the funeral, an earthquake shakes her husband's coffin lid, and she hits her head in the commotion. This causes her to have a short dream where Dylan disappears and she finds him in the burial plot, being dragged to hell by Freddy Krueger. Again, it probably isn't possible to dream while you're knocked unconscious, but maybe this time the dream occurred as she was coming back too, because the head trauma doesn't look as serious. That night, Dylan seems to be in a trance, standing in front of the TV, watching a Nightmare on Elm Street. It appears that he's sleepwalking, and most likely in the midst of a nightmare, based on his reaction when his mom wakes him up. When asked where he heard the Freddy nursery rhyme, he claims that he heard it from under his bed. The devil comparison that I made through the first four Elm Street films that kind of faded away after that is back in a very bold way when it comes to this version of Freddy Krueger. Freddy seems to take hold of Dylan again the next day at the playground. And can I just say, why is climbing on this thing even an option? Who designed this? Dylan almost seems to be mimicking what happened to Philip Anderson from A Nightmare on Elm Street 3 Dreamwalkers, the only Elm Street film outside of the original that Heather Langenkamp was in. It's almost as if Freddy is trying to use her past memories against her. As they say, the devil's in the details. Nancy and her co-star, John Saxon, are able to run over and catch the boy before he falls to the same fate that Philip did, but he still seems to be entranced afterwards. But the devil would, as Heather would find out that night when Freddy's claws poke through the fabric of her own reality. But unlike in A Nightmare on Elm Street, this time, he really is crossing over into her own reality. A loud crash from downstairs wakes her up, but evidence of his intrusion is there, just as it was in Tina Gray's pajamas a decade prior. Upon investigating the noise downstairs, she finds her son has now fashioned his own Freddy Krueger glove using kitchen knives, and he attacks her with it. Thankfully for her, this was also a dream. The longer Heather stays idle, the closer Freddy gets to the real world. During one of his mysterious phone calls, his tongue comes through the phone just like in Nightmare 1. Heather visits Wes Craven, and he tells her that she's a gatekeeper, the only person who can prevent Freddy from crossing over. The only way she can do this is by being in the movie. Only a storyteller can capture his essence. He may be telling the truth, but the method for stopping Freddy falls suspiciously in line with his motives as a film director. It would be like the brands I work with told me that the only way to save my family is to promote their audiobook service or meal delivery kits. Things get even more real when Freddy takes the lives of two more special effects artists who've been prepping for the movie, and the animatronic Freddy glove goes miss. Eventually, Heather's fears are confirmed. After being rocked by another big earthquake, she investigates the noise in her closet. Heather's attempted escape from Freddy Krueger results in her being wrestled onto her back. More and more, her scenes as Nancy Thompson in the original movie are coming true. Freddy even refers to her as Nancy Allen. Another earthquake shakes her awake, but she isn't unscathed. She tries to stay with her son as long as possible at the hospital, but grows exhausted, leading to increasing dreams and hallucinations of Freddy. Because of this, he continually gets closer to crossing over into the real world. A Nightmare on Elm Street played with the idea of blurring the line between dream and reality. As Nancy became more sleep-deprived, she started to experience her nightmare in the real world. This mirrored her troubling home situation, where her mother's alcohol abuse blurred her own lines of reality in a constant limbo between sobriety and drunkenness. Now Heather has grown up, and she's experiencing a new form of blurred reality, losing sight of the line between fiction and the real world. She increasingly starts to see scenes that she's acted in taking hold in her own life, like when she goes to find where Dylan is being treated.
Do you have a pass? Where's your
pass? Dylan has moved to a room for special care and sedated. Although his babysitter tries to keep him awake, he becomes drowsy enough to see Freddy Krueger appear behind her and gore her in the back. She's lifted into the air, much like Tina was in A Nightmare on Elm Street, and Dylan witnesses the horrific murder of his babysitter. Freddy comes for him next, but Dylan is also a sleepwalker, and he's determined to escape. The chase takes him across a busy freeway, where a deity like Freddy of disguise nearly turns him into roadkill. Then, an entire Krueger army chases him back home. His mother is relieved to finally catch up with him, but they're also visited by a concerned friend, John Saxon, who played Nancy Thompson's dad in the movie. He, too, starts calling her Nancy, seemingly having turned into his character from the film. Heather refuses to play along at first, but she continues to see more and more of the movie coming true before her eyes, until eventually she just caves in and decides to play Nancy Thompson.
I love you, too.
And in any other scenario, calling your coworker daddy while off the job might raise a few eyebrows, even if you are a professional actor. But this represents Heather playing the character, which is what Wes Craven told her she would need to do to stop Freddy.
I think the only way to stop is to make a movie. So we have a mistake about this movie. People are going to tell us this movie.
We can assume that this is where he finally reaches and kidnaps the boy, just as he had in the movies, bringing him to his lair with plans to harvest his soul. Because when Heather returns to the house, which is now transformed into 1428 Elm Street, Dylan is nowhere to be found. Only a trail of sleeping pills that he refused to take at the hospital. She realizes what she must do. Follow Nancy's footsteps by going into the dreams to face Krueger. She slides into the world of dreams, where she spit out of a giant underworlded Freddy Krueger shrine that drops her into a deep pit. She lands in a pool surrounded by Doric columns where there are only two sources of light, the heavenly luminescence shining down from above, and the warm glow of the hellish fires that surround the sacred. The scene looks like something mythological, somewhere you would expect an ancient tale of gods and demons to unfold. Since Freddy's emergence, Dylan has been trying to reach God to protect him from the devil that is masquerading as Freddy Krueger.
I'm just God.
But when no God came to his rescue, Heather had to take things into her own hands and realize that divine will. Freddy stalks her from just beyond her field of vision, just as Nancy had in the boiler room in Elm Street. Her search for Dylan brings her to this sort of Greek temple in the underworld, where she discovers friezes of terrifying-looking entities, perhaps other forms that the dream demon has taken over the years. At one point, she nearly backs into a giant stone bowl with the word Lethe on it, referring to Lethe, one of the five rivers of the underworld in Greek mythology. It was believed that when souls died and entered the underworld, they would drink from the waters of the river Lethe to forget their earthly lives and memories. This also ties in with the idea of Heather leaving her earthly life behind to take on the role of a god and find and rescue her son from Freddy Krueger. Dylan finds her, but then, so does Freddy. He throws her into a pot which shatters, and she's left lying in a shallow pool of snakes, which she tries to force her head into. The snakes are also a biblical reference. The original Nightmare on Elm Street features many examples of characters trying to turn to Christianity to save them, but to no avail. Christianity holds this concept of the original sin, where Adam and Eve were instructed not to eat the forbidden fruits, but Eve was tempted by a serpent, who is often interpreted as a representation of the devil. The idea is to teach that sin is an inherently human trait, so Freddy pushing her face down into the serpent is meant to make her feel less divine and more human. But Heather uses his attack against him, grabbing one of the snakes by its head and forcing it into his eye. Nancy is the gatekeeper. She's not going to be the one to sin, but she'll gladly wait for Freddy to make a mistake. She also delivers a pretty solid punch to the face and beats him with a torch. Torches are another symbolic artifact when it comes to Greek mythology, often seen as a connection between the mortal world and the gods. For example, Prometheus was the god of fire who stole fire from the gods of Olympus and gifted it to humanity. One tradition that still exists today is the passing of the torch at competitions such as the Olympics, which symbolizes the continuity of tradition and the connection between the athletes and the gods, as the Olympics were considered a sacred event by the Greeks. But there's also a double meaning here, because Freddy Krueger was burned alive by the Elm Street parents, some might say torched in the world of the movies. But even this doesn't prevent him from getting the upper hand and pinning Heather to a stone tablet with the word lust written on it. A surefire callback to the intimate subtext present between Krueger and Nancy on the screen. It's part of a greater display of the seven deadly sins, again calling back to the idea of conflating humanity with sin. Lucky for her, Dylan comes to the rescue, stabbing Freddy in the leg before scampering away. He tosses Heather aside and chases Dylan to the Spartans. She's knocked out momentarily, but eventually runs to the sounds of her child's distress when she's slowed down by this ground spot on the stairs, just like what Nancy found herself stuck in on the stairs of the Elm Tree. Freddy uses his extended arms to reach and grab the boy. Then, in a move that we've never seen in the movies, stretches his mouth open to an impossible size with the intention of devouring him whole. A new twist on the concept of consuming his victim's soul. But with half of Dylan's head engulfed in Freddy's gaping mouth, Heather arrives and stabs her rival in the back, allowing Dylan to get loose as Freddy writhes in pain. This time, Dylan is the one to face imagery of a snake. Meanwhile, his mother remains vicious with the knife. She can be seen pulling the blade right out of Freddy's crotch, something that no amount of pain tolerance can prepare you for. And perhaps the long time coming revenge for the years of child abuse and molestation, in the movie at least. Even after this, Freddy still manages to recuperate one more time, shooting out his tongue which wraps around her head, the fifth and final example in the history of Freddy Krueger's tongue. It is again Dylan who comes to the rescue, pinning down the devil's tongue with a knife, allowing the two of them to team up and push him into the fire once and for all. As they crank up the flames with this lever, we can see the result of Dylan's attack on Krueger's tongue. It gives him a forced tongue, a trait shared with many serpents, and of course, another attribute commonly associated with the devil. The devil that took the form of Freddy Krueger to come into our world would end up sharing the same fate as the character he so closely identified with. And in his final moments, we can see him transform into his true demonic form. But we've seen Freddy killed so many times in the dream world in the movies, only for him to come back and back and back. Who's to say that the same won't happen with the true dream demon, the one rooted in reality? I think there's a clue about his future. Heather and Dylan reawaken to the real world, and Heather finds the finished script to a movie that Wes Craven had been writing.
Thanks for having guts to play Nancy one last time. At last, Freddy's back where he belongs. The guards.
Going off the lore that Wes had provided earlier, which has proven to be accurate, capturing Freddy in a story will neutralize him for some time.
Every so often, I imagine a story good enough to sell. The wild is held from the earnings, while her heaven is when the story dies.
And now, with no new Nightmare on Elm Street for nearly 30 years...
Are you sure about that?
We don't talk about that. I think it's only a matter of time before the evil is set free once more. In the original iteration of Freddy Krueger, it was the fear of the children that kept him alive. And in our world, not the new Nightmare world, but in our real world, the legacy of these films has kept the fear of Freddy alive for several generations, and I can only imagine that will continue to haunt the nightmares of many generations. Remember to subscribe to CZ's World for new horrors every week, ring the death bell for all notifications, and I will see you in the next one, assuming we both survive.
Welcome back to another major compilation video where we took all of our spooky videos throughout October and have combined them for your pleasure. We just want to thank you guys real quick for all the support on the channel. You guys are serious with us. Also, we're on our way to our 20k sub goal, so make sure you subscribe. We have a lot more videos on the way and more massive compilations. We love you guys. Remember, enjoy time is never wasted time. And we'll see you next time. The ghost of Fallout. No, I'm not talking about the remnants of real society, like the Halloween decorations, or the gas stations filled with cars that haven't had drivers in over 200 years. I'm talking about actual ghosts. Spirits of the dead still roaming the wasteland because of unfinished business, or maybe something more. Let's dive into the hard truths about the ghosts of Fallout and see if we can discover something new about them, something unique. So where do we begin? Well,
Those who made their first appearance a long time ago in the Fallout franchise. In Fallout 2. You begin a quest by talking to the great Anonymous in the dead. He spins a tale about a princess poisoned by a sorcerer, which is a metaphor for Winslow's story. His tale leads you to a haunted room, where, at midnight, you encounter Anna's ghost. Yes, an actual ghost that will communicate. At this point, there isn't a denying the existence of ghosts in Fallout. Some people like to say that the developers of Fallout 1 and 2 didn't mean for things to be taken so literal. Like the aliens from Fallout, we just covered that. But this is wholly different, as it's not just an Easter egg. It's a fully fleshed out quest, where we're communicating with the dead. Sort of. No hallucinogens either. She talks about a locket, but she's unable to interact with you directly. To find the locket, you head to Mom's Diner southeast of the Slayer's Guild. Mom, the diner's owner, provides a clue about someone named Joseph or Joel who lived in Anna's house and left suddenly 2 years ago. This information directs you to Joey, one of the three thugs by the East End exit. Joey is in possession of Anna's locket. Here, you then have several options to retrieve it. Once you've secured the locket, return to Anna's ghost. Handing her the locket causes her to materialize in a whole pile of bones, signifying her soul's release from this world. Her unfinished business finally finished. But the quest isn't over yet. You must then give Anna a proper burial. You find a shovel near a bookcase in a room. Take it to the graveyard in the central part of the dead. Here, you'll need to locate Anna's gravestone
in the area of the
graveyard. Use the shovel to dig up the cloth, put a bone inside, and then cover the grave again with the shovel. Completing this task not only brings
and I get rocked by a Terminator.
Suggesting to us that this was the correct moral course of action. But who is Anna, and why is she a ghost? The only thing we really know is that her family lived in the den, and then they passed on. We don't know whether that was a tragic event, or just a regular one. It's even possible it happened before the bombs fell. We see tragedies everywhere in the wasteland. Everyone you meet in Fallout has a backstory of death or suffering. But ghosts are far and few between. Why did Anna's spirit decide to stay? I tried to find some answers to this, but all we have are theories. Possibly the locket is tied to her soul in some way, and when Joel stole it, she found herself restless. Obviously, this is the main point of the whole quest, but in Fallout, we retrieve lots of items that get people left behind, personal or otherwise. And never do we encounter a ghost like Anna in this sense. I don't know. We can look at it from a less lore perspective view and see that the developers of the next Fallout games probably wanted to stray away from the obvious supernatural and keep it more vague. We've talked about devs with this type of game before in the Fallout franchise, like Chris Avalon. But did they really keep it vague? Sometimes, but I'll say this. Every main Fallout installment after Fallout 2 has ghosts in it. One last thing before we move on to Fallout 2. There was cut content of a ghost that would have appeared in Sumit's village, the Umbra tribe. There are mods that restore this content, so we do know that there were plans to have more ghosts in the game. But since it's cut content, you can't count it as canon. But it is interesting to know. Fallout 3 is interesting when it comes to ghosts. They aren't in your face like Anna. We have to do some investigating, some ghost hunting if you will, to discover their ethereal presence. Let's talk about a major myth that burned through the internet in the early days of Fallout. The Arlington Ghost. It was similar to the Bigfoot conundrum in GTA San Andreas, if you're familiar with that. People seeing things that were odd or unexplained and reporting it to forums, which led others to do their own exploring and come up with stories or exaggerations that continue to fuel this story. Because, let's be honest, ghost stories are fun. But are there actual ghosts in the Arlington Cemetery? Personally, I would say yes, but not in the way you think. What people thought they were seeing turns out to mostly just be dust storms that appear sporadically, or there used to be this bug where Mr. Crowley from the underworld would spawn at the cemetery and run back home. I don't blame them. If you saw this from far away, you'd probably be freaked out too. Also, it is a cemetery, so it's inherently ghostly. But all of this is the shadows and the bugs in the night that led people into creating this little mythos. But rather recently, like a year ago, someone discovered that there is actually a ghost that is meant to be at the Arlington Cemetery. It's coded into the game and everything, meaning this is not cut content. But due to an LOD glitch on the PC version of the game and extremely low draw distance on the console versions, you can often see it. West Virginia Loner on the Fallout 3 subreddit found an NPC named Poey that spawns when you enter the Arlington World Space.
Looking further, he's equipped with combat armor and a combat helmet, and is coated with spawn and something at the grave with the flowers. And then he'll disappear after getting close to him. The myth was real all along. We just never quite see it. In my eyes, this is another confirmed ghost. Even if we have to use the back end of the game to see it. It's incredibly interesting and awesome to see. This is of course the ghost of a dead soldier or maybe a friend of one, visiting either his grave or a loved one. Other than cemeteries, we can of course head to the trusty Dunwich building for anything and everything of the creepy variety. Here, you can also hear strange voices that some people believe could be ghosts. When you find the obelisk in the basement, the voice that you can hear is repeating the name Alpha Red. In the stories of H.P. Lovecraft, Abdul Al-Hazred is the author of the Necronomicon, or the Book of the Dead. Pretty big giveaway if you take that at face value. Plus, you can actually find a book called the Crypt Vecna in the Point Lookout DLC, in another unholy location that's probably filled with spirits or demons or whatever. The book is a clear reference to the Necronomicon, and you can return it to the altar here in the Dunwich building and destroy it. Which elicits a whole
you're
gonna
say it. Say it right, then. Necronomicon.
Something worse. I don't know. It depends on your point of view. If you base it on the Necronomicon side of Lovecraft's works, then yes, we are dealing with a lot of ghosts and similar themes. If you look at it from the more Cthulhu and Dunwich side, then it's more like interdimensional beings and cosmic horrors. All bad, of course. There are also these strange hallucinations you get while passing through the Dunwich building, where you see people from pre-war times. I don't think these are actual ghosts, and they're just actual hallucinations caused by whatever the altar is. For me, it's harder to say that we're dealing with ghosts here than at the cemetery. And why is that? Because here, you're being influenced by outside forces. The obelisk is messing with your mind. It is inherently supernatural, of course, but it doesn't mean that there are ghosts here. Whereas at the cemetery, it's a pure experience. What do you guys think as far as the Dunwich Manor goes? Ghosts or no ghosts? Other than that, Fallout 3 has given us all she has to offer. It's not concrete, but I think there is some strong evidence to suggest that hauntings are occurring once again in the Wastes. Now in New Vegas, you can get absolute, concrete, without question, evidence of ghosts by talking to one man.
Ghosts. Army ghosts. Don't know they're dead. Hope you steal our rockets, so we can fly up and paint the moon pink and draw a melon face on it.
Okay, maybe not. But check out this clip of confirmed ghosts. It actually is kind of creepy, but it has been debunked, as in the original game, this is where Ulysses would have sat, and you could have recruited him to be a companion. Now, random prospector NPC spawns occur here and glitch out. Still kind of strange, though. Okay, without all the jokes, let's get to the nitty-gritty. Most of you know about the Good Spring Cemetery. Let's head up there and have a listen. As you can tell, there are ghostly whispers happening here as well. The souls of the dead reaching out for an unknown reason. What's more interesting is that this occurs whether you have the Wild Wasteland trait active or not. This is a canon event, solidifying yet again the existence of ghosts. There are other graveyards in Fallout that don't have this whispering. I try to find a connection between Arlington and here, but nothing really explains why this is happening. Possibly just spooky mysteries. But head to Camp Forlorn Hope in Bitter Springs, and you can also hear the whispers. These places have lots in common. Tragedies folded onto tragedies. Places where the dead shouldn't be dead, but they're restless here. This makes more sense to me, to find souls here that feel wronged in life. These are dark places underneath the surface, so here we have ghosts. What about Fallout 4? Well, this is where we circle back to Fallout 2 levels of ghost sightings. The first is the Dunwich Horrors. It's been talked about to death, and I'm sure you guys are exhausted over it like I am. It's very similar to the Dunwich building in 3. You go through the wars and have strange pre-war hallucinations, and you eventually arrive at another otherworldly altar that has infected the minds of the people here, including you. My theory here is the same as in 3. It's possibly ghosts, or more likely other supernatural forces at play. I just wanted to briefly mention it because it is similar to the Dunwich building. These places deserve their own videos, and trust me when I say they already have them. Loads of them. When it comes to ghosts, I'm a little more iffy on that. The more interesting ghost sighting happens in the Nuka World DLC, Lucy Granchester. I recently covered her in a video I did. I'm going to throw that segment in here so you can get an idea of what I'm working with. In the eerie outskirts of the Nuka World, where the lines between amusement and horror blur, stands the Granchester Mystery Mansion, a place where the past lingers with a spectral presence. At the heart of this ghostly narrative is Lucy Granchester, a figure whose story weaves through the mansion's dark corridors like a chill breeze. Lucy was born into the Granchester family, a seemingly ordinary lineage until tragedy struck. According to the lore whispered through the mansion's tour, Lucy, driven by the forces beyond her control, took the lives of her parents, Morticia and Hannibal. This act of violence led her to confinement in a mental asylum. On the eve of her 18th birthday, she made a daring escape, only to meet a grim fate in the mansion's attic, where she was found hanging, a victim of apparent suicide. Now, Lucy's spirit haunts the mansion, not as the young woman she was at death, but as a child, forever trapped in the innocence she lost. Her ghostly form appears sporadically, her presence felt in the cold spots and the silence that follows her. Visitors to the mansion might catch glimpses of her figure disappearing around corners or through walls, as if the mansion itself is playing tricks on the senses. Lucy's interactions with the world are limited, yet profound. When encountered during moments of chaos or battle, she might flee, her ghostly form darting away from the conflict. There's an intriguing visual phenomenon associated with Lucy. When viewed from certain angles near the mansion's windows, her shadow seems to sprout wings, an optical illusion that adds to the mansion's mystique. Some might assume that Lucy is just another haunted house trick, an illusion to scare others and get their money's worth. But no, she's not part of the attraction. This is an actual ghost in Fallout, guys. Like, confirmed right in front of our eyes. By the way, she did die when she was 18, but she appears as a child in her ghost form. I'm sure we could have a whole psychological breakdown vid for why this is the case, but let's just move on. I wish we knew more about why she killed her parents, or if that story is even true at all. But there's no more lore that we get on Lucy besides the narrator in the house. From what we can surmise, Lucy was involved with a tragedy, similar to Anna and most of the other ghosts in these games. If she did kill her parents, maybe her soul is cursed to wander the halls for eternity. Or maybe her story was never fully told and she can't rest until it is. But I think we're starting to connect some dots between the ghostly sightings, and it's one that many people believe in our own world, that spirits or ghosts are usually trapped here because of unfinished business and horrors that occur to them. Fallout 76 is interesting. Take the Alpine River cabins. If you're new to this game, this place is going to set you on edge. You'll hear screams and the floor shaking. Pictures and other objects seemingly moving on their own. Clearly, this place is haunted. Until you realize that these cabins are actually designed to scare people and you can shut off the tech running these scares. You'll find it in a treehouse terminal located nearby. Haven Church, on the other hand, may be the real deal. When you get here, you learn about a story of raiders that decided to occupy said church. At night, they began to hear strange music coming from the organ pipes, but no one was playing. Nor is there an organ in the church. There's a piano, but it plays completely different music. To their location, and eventually they were overran. You can come here at night and you can also hear the organ music. One of the raiders here will explain in journal entries that he believed that the place was haunted as well. There's a whole story surrounding this place about ghosts and the possibility of them.
But in the end, it turns out that the organs were connected to an automatic system that the church had designed and now is malfunctioning. Once again, we're left with no ghosts in Fallout 76. I'll be honest, I don't know much about 76. Through research, I couldn't find any concrete evidence of ghosts in 76. Mostly it's hoaxes or odd occurrences that can be explained away. I thought maybe the Berkeley Hill Castle would hold some evidence, but nothing really happens there. Anyways, if you guys know anything about ghosts in 76, leave it in the comments below, because I am curious. Obviously, 76 is full of supernatural stuff, but the ghost variety isn't one of them, apparently. Which feels off. Ghosts in Fallout are they important to the overall narrative or world? Not really. Or should I say, not yet. They mostly exist to provide atmosphere and eerie nuance. I guess the truth about the ghosts in Fallout is that almost all of them are connected through some type of tragedy, similar to what people believe in the real world. They haunt because they want something, or something happened to them. The souls of those dead in places like Bitter Springs and Forlorn Hope are restless because of what may have happened to them. How they fit into Fallout is yet to be explained. Maybe one day we'll get a DLC or some explanation about their existence. But until then, we will just have to keep it here.
Scientists, representing the world's foremost research centers, took part in an examination of the evidence. The facts that will be presented are true. This may be the most startling thing you'll ever see. New legendary creatures that could anybody be found.
Existence is disputed or unsubstantiated by science. This is the study of cryptozoology. In Fallout, creatures with a gruesome myth turn out to be more than that. The unexplained sometimes becomes the explained, or sometimes they don't. Deathclaws are a good example of this, as they used to be cryptids to the Southern California wastelands, but it turns out they were real. They spread out all across the states, whereas creatures like the Wamingo or cryptids believed to be aliens, we have yet to discover their origin or an explanation. Let's begin our hunt for Fallout's elusive cryptids. This elusive piece, we need to obtain the quest called Unsolved Death from Taxi. Once we have that, we need to head to Prelos Curios, where you'll find a holotape on a crate next to a Brahmin sword. It's about a woman named Janelle, who's speaking to a man named Rainer, and explaining some troubling things that are occurring in the wilds of Appalachia. I'll let you have a listen as we hear for the first time about the piece.
Rainer, I'll mirror you with the things I need to know. This is big. This is the real deal. I found her dead there. Shredded body. Something. I don't know. I met a woman in that room who said there's a female monster up here. The beast, she said. Listen, this thing, if it is half as weird as it sounds, it could be a gold mine. Crazy cowards are paying out the nose for it. Wait a minute. This is a game changer. We could finally buy the shop outrighter. We could get a new truck or hire some help. Okay. Please bring those supplies to my old fishing camp near the pond for the bed. This is where I caught that two-headed fish, remember? It was probably back to my hunting camp and my old truck by the shop. So drive down here and come look for my camp. Park near my car on the road. Okay. Oh, and, bring I've been in the house for the next 2 weeks. I know it's taken longer than usual, but maybe I really think it'll be worth it this time.
Janelle
has excitedly shared a significant discovery with Green, hinting at a potentially lucrative opportunity. He now found a bear that was killed in an unusual way, suggesting the presence of something dangerous or mysterious in the area. She then encountered a woman, Becca, who spoke of a creature known locally as the Beast, described as pale and monstrous. She now believes this discovery could be turned into a gold mine, possibly by selling the story or rights to someone named Calvin. This financial gain could help them achieve significant goals like buying their own shop, purchasing a new vehicle, or hiring staff. She asked Raymond to bring supplies to her old fishing camp nearby, north of Beckley, using a memorable past event, her catching a two-headed fish, as a reference point. She mentions there might be a map in her old truck by the shop to help him find the location. Janelle apologizes for being away for nearly 2 weeks, longer than she expected, but she implies that the potential payoff for this adventure justifies the time delay. In essence, Janelle is suggesting that what she stumbled upon could be a turning point for them financially and professionally, urging Raymond to join her with necessary supplies to possibly investigate or exploit the Beast, but no further. Our next step is to head to the location of Janelle's camp. Not much is here besides some basic resources, but we do have several notes and holotapes that feel pretty horrific end to both Raymond and Janelle. The first is a note to Raymond from Janelle. It says, "Raymond, just drop off the supplies in the tent and wait here. Do not walk around with the bait. I just went up the hill to check if the cave again. I think the Beast is close. If you're spooks, stay safe, sit tight. I'll be back ASAP." Raymond, on his way to the camp, had something different in his mind, other than the gnashing of the teeth of the local Beast. He wants to remind you about the financial stability of the business, which relies on trapping and selling to Calvin. He notes that none of Janelle's experimental taxidermy pieces sold last month, indicating potential financial strength. Raymond is grappling with balancing business realities, personal safety, and emotional support for Janelle's ambitions, showing a mix of concern, practicality, and affection in his approach.
It's a long drive. May as well rehearse this before I slap your face. Breathe, Raymond. You can do it. Sure, listen. Okay. I'm gonna say, Janelle, honey, I will help you kill this critter. But we gotta get back to basics so the business can survive. Maybe I should remind her that none of the experimental taxidermy sold last month. No, that's mean. She loved making them. Okay. Let's see, more support. I want you to keep being able to make your art. It brings a smile to your face that I always want to see. But going off to hunt real monsters? It's too dangerous. We're just trappers. And most of the shit is roadkill. Calvin buys almost all our stock every